Good afternoon. I'm Dr. Zihai Li, founding director of the Pelotonia Institute for Immuno-Oncology, or PIIO. I want to begin by welcoming all of you to join us for our second annual PIIO symposium today. The theme of our program this year is Navigating Through the Storm. Immuno-Oncology Pushes Forward. We believe that this theme is fitting because it captures how all of us have experienced in the year of 2020, both literally and metaphorically. The PIIO is a comprehensive bench-to-bedside research initiative focusing on harnessing the body's immune system to fight cancer at all levels, from prevention to treatment and survivorship. It is not just an idea, but the deep commitment from all of us at Ohio State to advancing immuno-oncology in a major strategic way, and our conviction that IO holds the key to cancer cure. This institute was launched on July 26, 2019, a mere 1 year ago, supported by a $102 million pledge from the James Comprehensive Cancer Center and our amazing philanthropic partner, Pelotonia. We immediately embarked on strategic planning process and rolled out our plan in July 2020, which I will highlight. During the process, we have built an immune monitoring and discovery platform. By the end of this year, I'm proud to announce that we will have 15 new faculty members recruited to PIIO, adding to an already existing team of 50 plus researchers and clinicians in immuno-oncology at Ohio State. Our strategic plan was developed under the guidance of our scientific advisory board. The internal SAB is composed of physicians, basic scientists, and leaders in IO or other areas of academic medicine, representing 9 departments, 3 colleges, and 2 organizations, including The Ohio State University and Nationwide Children's Hospital. Our ESAB is chaired by Dr. Lieping Chen from Yale University, who discovered PD-L1 molecule and is a true pioneer in immuno-oncology. The members include Dr. Lisa Butterfield from the Park Institute for Cancer Immunotherapy, who's known for her work in developing liver cancer vaccine, as well as melanoma vaccine. Dr. Carl June from University of Pennsylvania, who leads the field of CAR T-cell therapy for leukemia and beyond. Dr. Miriam Marad from Arkansas School of Medicine at Mount Sinai, who is among the first in defining the developmental mechanisms of cancer-resident dendritic cells and macrophages. Dr. Rob Schreiber from Washington University in St. Louis, who established the cancer immune editing concept and has contributed to the renaissance of cancer immunology. And Dr. Catherine Yee from MD Anderson, who's known for his work in advancing adoptive T-cell therapy for solid tumors. Now here's the PIIO strategic plan. I'm very proud to share that with you. Our aspiration is to become a leader in driving immuno-oncology breakthroughs. Our strategic goals are to become an institute of choice for immuno-oncology talent, to lead groundbreaking IO discoveries and solutions in several areas of research excellence that I will detail further momentarily, to become a top site in the world for practice-changing IO clinical trials, to be recognized as a model for fostering impactful strategic collaborations with other academic centers and biotech industry, to create a robust and sustainable foundation to advance the strategic priorities of the Institute. The implementation of this plan has already begun, despite the COVID-19 pandemic and other challenges. We have identified 4 strategically important research domains for investment and growth. They are being implemented through the creation of 4 centers and 2 platforms for fueling immuno-oncology discoveries. The cell therapy center is being built in collaboration with Division of Hematology by taking advantage of our existing GMP cell manufacturing facility and stem cell transplant program. The area of immunogenomics is being pursued in collaboration with Institute for Genomic Medicine in Nationwide Children's Hospital and Department of Cancer Biology and Genetics at Ohio State. When it comes to fundamental immunology, we are working very closely with Department of Microbial Infection and Immunity and Department of Biomedical Informatics to accelerate discovery using systems immuno-oncology approach. Finally, we advance our clinical IO program by leveraging the large patient volume and our huge clinical infrastructure to translate laboratory findings into the clinic. In collaboration with all members of the James Comprehensive Cancer Center, especially physicians from the Division of Medical Oncology. I'm pleased to report that important discoveries have already been made in each of the four research programs. Our immune monitoring and discovery platform gives our investigators access to the very latest technology in cancer immunology research. With ambition of building a top-notch immune monitoring service, the IMDT delivers high-content spectral flow cytometry, mass cytometry, single-cell proteomics and genomics, spatial informatics, and so on. We're also working with data scientists in the Department of Biomedical Informatics to create immuno-oncology database to deposit searchable clinical as well as research data in real time to transform our capabilities to perform translational IO research. Our goal is to deliver a complete package covering five essential elements of translational research: tissue acquisition, precision assay, database establishment, deep analysis with bioinformatics tools, and clinical translation of our findings. So what is our scorecard for the first year? We collectively have competed well nationally by securing $16 million of extramural funding, most of which are from the National Institutes of Health. The PIO members have launched more than 25 new clinical trials, published more than 265 manuscripts in peer-reviewed journals, and filed 19 invention disclosures. As I said, we have already recruited 15 new faculty members to the PIO, and this number is growing. Our immediate goal is to recruit 20 additional new faculty members to PIO, including senior leaders to direct our four flagship IO centers. With the extraordinary support of the fantastic Ohio State community, as well as our amazing philanthropic partner, Pelotonia, I am optimistic that we are closer to realize our vision towards cancer cure by advancing immuno-oncology day by day. Now back to our main program today. I can't be prouder and happier to have assembled a great lineup of speakers for you today, including Dr. Tony Ribas from UCLA, Dr. Miriam Marad from Mount Sinai, and our newest ESAB member, our own Dr. David Carbone from the James, Dr. Christian Jovan from the University of Florida, Dr. Elaine Modis from Nationwide Children's Hospital, our own Dr. Jean Oates, and finally, Dr. Kathleen Yee from MD Anderson. I don't think I'm exaggerating at all by saying that all our speakers today are visionary leaders in their respective field. I want to thank each and every one of you personally and on behalf of PIO for sharing your expertise, knowledge, and vision in immuno-oncology with us. It is truly an exciting day. Finally, I want to thank all of you for participating in today's program. If you want to know more about PIO, please browse our website at cancer.osu.edu/PIO. For those of you who are interested in joining our team as faculty members, please feel free to contact me directly or sending your application by following the instruction on this slide. So thank you very, very much. Enjoy the 2020 PIO Symposium, and don't forget to vote tomorrow.
Thank you so much for that introduction. That was fantastic, Dr. Lee. It is my esteemed pleasure today to introduce our first speaker, Dr. Antonio Ribas. He is a professor of medicine, professor of surgery, professor of molecular and medical pharmacology at UCLA. There, he serves as director of the tumor immunology program at the Jonassen Comprehensive Cancer Center and is director of the Parker Institute for Cancer Immunotherapy Center. Dr. Ribas is a physician scientist who conducts laboratory and clinical research in malignant melanoma and focuses on gene engineering T cells, PD-1 blockade, and BRAF targeted therapies. Dr. Ribas has been instrumental in the clinical development of several FDA approved agents, including pembrolizumab, vemurafenib, cobimetinib, dabrafenib, and trametinib. Dr. Ribas currently serves as the president of the American Association for Cancer Research and is an elected member of the Fellows of the AACR Academy, as well as the American Society of Clinical Investigation. Dr. Ribas's contributions to immunology and cancer therapy is widely recognized, and he has received multiple prestigious awards throughout his career, including, but not limited to, the NCI Outstanding Investigator Award, the 2019 William B. Coley Award in Basic and Tumor Immunology from the Cancer Research Institute, and most recently, the 2020 ESMO Award for Translational Research. It is my pleasure to introduce Dr. Ribas for the first speaker.
Hello, I want to thank the organizers for the kind invitation to be part of this interesting program. I'll start with my disclosures. I have consulted for a series of companies and I'm in the scientific advisory board of companies. There's one that's relevant, ACPharma, and I'm going to bring this up as I go over data that we've generated for them. What I'm going to be talking about is the mechanism of how T cells that are unleashed to attack cancer by releasing their brakes, either CTLA-4, which is in the activation step, or PD-1, which is an effector step of T cells attacking tumor, how do they recognize and attack the cancers? As you know, this was the this biology led to the 2018 Nobel Prizes to Jim Allison and Tasuku Honda. And this has so much impact because if we take away these breaks to the immune system, we can get cancers that are metastatic that had no cure before to disappear. Here's a patient of mine, an early patient who was on an anti-PD-1 phase one trial. This is a large mass in the lung, pleural effusion. This is a mass in the liver. There's more melanoma in the liver than there is normal liver. And we just block PD-1, just one molecule that's on T cells, not on tumor cells, we can have responses like these. This patient continues to to be alive and well and going on with this with his life. This patient sent me a picture and he sent an email saying, you can use this picture in your presentation. And this is what a human with this kind of cancer looks like, where the cancer was eating out from him. He was losing muscle strength. He lost balance and hit his head. I did not scan his head because that would have taken him out of the phase one trial. But we gave him this anti-PD-1 and we can see him months later, actually a couple of years later, completely healthy, going on with his life in a pamphlet of promoting UCLA health. I'm showing you this because these are the impacts that it has in patients. And we need to study this biology. We need to understand why Tom responded and other patients do not respond. But the key point about this is that the antibody that blocks PD-1 is not the real drug here. The real drug is the T cells that infiltrate this cancer that was progressing and is responding here. We take a biopsy before and there's very few T cells. The brown dot, small dots are the T cells. it would take a responding lesion is full of immune cells that are mediating the response. And we need to know, how do they attack the cancer? How do these T cells know that they have to attack this lesion and not the normal one? And that is because T cells are evolved by nature to recognize the small differences between a cancer cell and a normal cell. And those are point mutations that change one nucleotide that changes one amino acid that's presented on the cell surface by MHC molecules. When this happens, T cells can recognize these mutations. It's obvious that if there's more mutations, it's more likely that T cells may be recognizing the cancer cells compared to the normal cells. And that's why tumors with a higher tumor mutation burden are more likely to respond to this class of therapies. When this happens, the T cells make interferon gamma, and then they would be blocked by this PD-L1, and then we therapeutically take away this negative interaction by taking away this checkpoint, then the interferon leads to the production of a series of interferon response genes, including chemokines that attract more T cells, that also increase antigen presentation that keeps amplifying the tumor response. But all of these still depends on one receptor to ligand interaction, which is the T cell receptor recognizing a mutation in the cancer, or so we think that's the case. So we wanted to really study this interaction, but it's not easy to study because there's over 9,000 HLA class 1 alleles in the human population. And mutations of cancers are not common. They are different in every patient, the majority of mutations. The driver mutations are unlikely to be the ones that are immunogenic. So we have to match mutations and HLAs and develop technologies that can recognize this high diversity of interactions. And once we recognize these, then we want to take the T cell receptors that recognize the mutations and test if they're really functioning the way we think that they're functioning once we have isolated. So we have to generate technologies to be able to put these T cell receptors back into T cells and then characterize their function. And to do this, we need to have matched cell lines from the same patients that we analyze. A whole bunch of things that are not easy to do. But let's start with the first problem, which is isolating T cell receptors that recognize a mutation presented by whatever HLA that the patient has. And to do this, Sun Ming Peng working in the lab of Jim Keith, and Michael Bethune working in the lab of David Baltimore, and Jesse Zareski, who was a graduate student in my lab, teamed up to be able to create a new technology based on soluble MHC peptide complexes that were barcoded so we could, and they were multimerized, so we could efficiently pull rare T cells that recognize a point mutation that was presented by these in these multimerized HLA peptide complexes and be able to isolate those cells. And the idea would be something like this, where we have normal cells and cancer cells. We do exome sequencing and RNA sequencing, so we can computationally describe the HLA A, B, and C, the two alleles, the maternal and paternal allele for each person, and then be able to know what's the presenting molecule, and then look for mutations that could be presented and used bioinformatic approaches that were pioneered by Elaine Mardis to align those mutations and then match them with the ability of different HLA class ones to present these mutations. And once those are aligned, then we can start making these multimers that are barcoded and include the HLA and the peptide. And those are made in multi-wells by protein engineering, and each well is making one HLA of the six of the patient with one mutation, and then we plan to make hundreds of them. We mean my colleagues at PAC Pharma using the technology that was pioneered by Jim Keith. And then we make these multimers, and then we can start flowing T cells and seeing which T cells bind to one of them and which T cells passing by. Here we have these two cells that bind to this mutation or this other mutation. We'll be able to resolve them by the barcode. This T cell binds to the same mutation, and then these other T cells do not bind to a different one. So then we can then isolate the T cells and clone their T cell receptor based on the recognition of a peptide HLA complex. And we've done these, being CRISPR cells, who's a junior faculty working out of my lab, and our colleagues at PAC Pharma, who have made these capture reagents and cloned the T cell receptors from five cases that Chris was studying, two of them being patients who responded to anti-PD-1 therapy, and three of them were patients also with metastatic melanoma who did not respond to anti-PD-1. And she chose these five cases because she had TILs and peripheral blood from different time points, and also because she had made a cell line out of the same biopsies from which we get the T cell, the tumor infiltrating lymphocytes. So the patients with a response had their melanomas had higher number of mutations than the patients without a response. At PAC Pharma, they made multiple capture reagents from each one of them based on the HLAs that had there was enough knowledge for the presentation of the peptides. So for example, from this case that had 2,562 mutations, they made 243 neoantigen HLA complexes. And for example, from this patient without a response that had 193 mutations, they were able to make 172 HLA peptide complexes. And then they were flown they were co-cultured with the T cells from the patients. And we look at how many mutations had T cells that recognized them. And it's surprising to us that even from high or low mutational load, we have a rather constant handful number of mutations that are recognized by doing this wide arrays. Three mutations, five mutations, one, and two mutations. So these suggest that there's a phenomenon of immunodominance where despite having multiple mutations or very few mutations, the ones that are immunogenic are a constant. Something that has been described for years in infectious diseases and now is becoming evident with the COVID-19 pandemic, where COVID-19 has 29 proteins that our body, most of them has not seen them, but only a handful of those, not all 29 proteins are being recognized by T cells, only a minority of them in a viral immunodominance. So here we also see a tumor immunodominance. But what separated the patients who responded to therapy or not was by the number of T cell receptors that recognize these mutations. Because from these three mutations, we were able to pull 14 different T cell receptors. From recognition of these five mutations, there were 21 T cell receptors, but in these cases, there was only one or two T cell receptors, suggesting that there was much more amplification and polyclonality in responders than non-responders. But I need to convince you that that's the case. So now I need to take all of these T cell receptors, there were 40 isolated, and clone them back into T cells. But making 40 retro lentiviruses is not that efficient. So in parallel, we have to develop a new technology, which is based on CRISPR editing that allows in one step to knock out the endogenous T cell receptor and knock in the transgenic T cell receptor in an approach that CRISPR cells had optimized with Theo Roth and Alex Marson, who have developed this process of taking human T cells and knocking out a certain gene and knocking in that same place a transgene. And in this case, Theo and Chris inserted a T cell receptor so they can genetically redirect T cells to recognize with the new transgene T cell receptor. And by doing this, it can take a population of T cells that have their endogenous T cell receptor and then have them not express the endogenous T cell receptor, and in a fraction of them, insert the transgenic T cell receptor. And this is technology that has been optimized by Carl Jacobian, his colleagues at PAC Pharma, to be able to do this in a highly efficient way. So then we can have clones of T cells that are now expressing the transgenic T cell receptor, not their endogenous T cell receptor, and then be able to see, are those T cell receptors that we recognize from these five cases attacking an antigen, an HLA matched tumor that we established from a biopsy from the same patients. So if we look back into this cartoon, we now want to see do these T cell receptors recognize the cancer? And I'm going to show you data from the first one, and then I'll summarize for the other five cases. Because on the first one, we established a cell line. It was labeled in red, so we can culture it with T cells. And if we put the matched T cell receptor that recognizes a mutation and the endogenous HLA, we can have anti-tumor activity. If we put the control T cell receptor, the cancer cells will grow progressively. If we put the data into a graph, we can see that the cancer cells will grow progressively until they become confluent, and that the cancer cells that are in the wells with the T cells that have the matched T cell receptor, they will have pull from the blood on the tumors of patients. We have anti-tumor activity. This does not get to zero because there's always some red pigment left. But this was one of the 14 T cell receptors we extracted from the first case. The other 13 T cell receptors also were all hits. They also all killed the matched tumor cell. So we go back to this case. There were 4,562 mutations. We made an array of 243 captured reagents that allowed to isolate three mutations that were recognized by 14 T cell receptors, and all 14 T cell receptors were able to kill the cell line that was established from the patient. In the other cases, there were 21 of these other cases with anti-PD-1 response, and all of them also recognized that the cell line that we had established from the patient's melanoma. And even in the patients who did not respond to anti-PD-1, we were also able to pull some T-cell receptors, but those were much less T-cell receptors because they had more or less mutations, but also they were not polyclonal. But those T cell receptors, when we co-cultured them with cell lines that we have established from the baseline biopsy, the 5 out of 5 T cell receptors also kill the endogenous cell line. So with this, I want to convey to you that the efficacy of PD-1 blockade therapy is because there's polyclonal T cells that are recognizing immunodominant mutations that serve as neoantigens, true neoepitopes, that we can isolate T-cell receptors from blood and tumors of these patients. And I've not shown you that we can do this at multiple times. And we always find the same mutations and the same TCRs recognizing the tumors. And then we can test their functionality by co-culturing them with established cell lines from the same patients. And that works in patients who have a response to therapy that have polyclonal T-cell responses, and also patients who did not have response to anti-PD-1 therapy, could still clone T cell receptors and have them recognize the cancer, suggesting to us that we could use this as a therapeutic by gene engineering. So the data that I've shown you was funded by the grants from the National Institute of Health, by the Parker Institute, and a series of other grants that support my lab. And most of the work was done by Christina Puch-Saus, working at some of the work with Jesse Zareski, with our colleagues in the lab of Alex Marson, David Baltimore, and Jim Keith, and our colleagues at Pharma. I'll be happy to take any questions. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Dr. Rivas, for that wonderful presentation. I'm looking here right now at the question and answers, and I don't see any specific questions, but I do see, I guess, a hand that has been raised by, is it Debbie Tingler? I don't know if that was intentional or... Debbie? Okay.
I can see that there's a question there. It says, what are examples of neoantigens? And do they, and examples of neoantigens are random. They're, I can read some of the genes. There's one, IL-8, that I would recognize, but in the case that had three mutations that were recognized, one was IL-8, the other one was POM-1 and TPP2. I can look for other cases, but they're just, any gene that can have a mutation, and you have, in case of 2,500 mutations, there's a limited set that are immunogenic, and it's unlikely that it's going to be the driver mutations of that cancer. There are occasional examples of that. Eric Tran and Steve Rosenberg have described mutations that can be targets of T cells from TILs in KRAS or P53, but those are uncommon. The majority are just hitting any mutation.
just looking then here through the chat. So let's see. There's a comment from Dr. Lee, but it doesn't look like necessarily a question. Here's a question. So does the standard chemotherapy affect the frequency of the tumor-specific T cells?
We have not tested this because I treat melanoma where we barely ever use chemotherapy. I think I've used chemotherapy once in the last 2 years. The idea that chemotherapy or radiation therapy could increase the mutational load and then make tumors more immunogenic is an idea that has been tested, and it does not hold true because the important are the truncal mutations, the mutations that are in the founder cell that are carried to all of the progeny. If you induce more mutations afterwards, then the immune system doesn't have ability to recognize so many new mutations. And also every mutation is going to be different in different cancer cells that will grow as subclones. So that will not take care of the overall problem.
Okay. And I guess somewhat related, is did you look at this question with IPI?
No, but I would not think it would be different because for IPI or for anti-PD-1 or anti-CTLA-4, what kills the cancer is the T cell that is recognizing something different in the cancer cell from normal cell. And that's most likely going to be a mutation or a viral protein or an overexpressed lineage-specific protein. So I would assume would be the same.
Okay. To go to the question and answer panel, so is there a particular reason why so few neoantigens are recognized by T cells?
This phenomenon of immunodominance has been described in the infectious disease literature for 30 or 40 years. And I don't think that we know exactly how it works. So let's take a recent example. The SARS-CoV-2 virus has 29 proteins. Whenever people have looked at for T cell responses to SARS-CoV-2, it's not any of the 29 proteins. It's just certain proteins are more immunogenic than others. The old viral literature shows that if one of these proteins was not expressed by the virus anymore, then another one would become immunogenic. So that there's this funnel activity of the immune system that I don't know that it's well, that the mechanism, I don't know it's known.
Let's go back to the question and answer section. So have you detected tumor-specific CD4 T cell clones using this approach?
No, because the approach is based on the ability to have capture reagents, which are MHC class 1 peptide complexes. The binding of MHC class 2 to peptides to MHC class 2 is a lot less defined and a lot less, it's harder to predict, but the last speaker is Bob Schreiber in this conference, and Bob has been able to do this in mouse models. So we hope that in the future we'll be able to do it in humans.
Okay. For the next question is, how do we take research from one cancer type and expand it to others? Do we need to repeat all experiments, or are there certain specifics we can hone in on one?
If we look at the field of immune checkpoint blockade, it started with melanoma and now there's approvals for over 15 cancers. But that doesn't mean that this class of drugs work the same in every one of them. And some of them work even better, like Hodgkin's disease or MSI-high cancers, the cancers that accumulate a lot of mutations. The constant of all of these approvals for immune checkpoint blockade therapies is, let's see, the cancers that accumulate mutations, either from a carcinogen like the sun or cigarette smoking, or from mismatch repair where they're not correct their own mutations, or there's viral antigens, or in the case of Hodgkin's disease, there's an amplification of the PDJ genomic locus, which is PD-L1, PD-L2 injected.
Okay, and then this is the last question here. So can you see T cells that respond to tissue antigens after treatment with PD-1 therapy?
We have not studied them with this technology because we look for point mutations that become immunogenic, that become recognized by T cells. But there has to be recognition of lineage antigens in melanoma. Patients could respond to this class of therapies. The great majority of them develop vitiligo or depigmentation of the skin, which is an immune response mediated by T cells to pigmented antigens in normal skin melanocytes, something that's been called epitope spreading or antigen spreading. We do not know if the T cell responses to pigmented antigens are the starters of an immune response. I know they develop with time. If we look at the data from Steve Rosenberg on TIL therapy, they could detect T cells that would recognize MARC1, GP100, tyrosinase, and other pigmented antigens, but they could map them the tumor activity mostly to the mutation, the recognition of a mutation that would break tolerance and start the response.
Okay, great. So I think with that, I think we are right out of time, right about 1:40. So thank you so much, Dr. Rivas, and thank you for the questions.
I wanted to recognize that the first question was from my friend, Claire Vershagen. So hi to many friends in the audience. Bye.
Hello, it's my great pleasure to introduce our next speaker, Dr. Mira Murad. Dr. Mira Murad is the professor in cancer immunology and a director of Precision Immunology Institute at Mount Sinai. She was also elected as a president of International Union of Immunological Society. She is truly one of the top leaders in innate immunity, and I have been following her work for a decade. Her lab made many advances to our fundamental understanding of the origin and the development pathway that regulate tissue-resident dendritic cell and the macrophage, and their functional role in homeostasis, inflammatory disease, more importantly, in cancer. So for example, her landmark Nature Immunology paper showed that tissue-resident dendritic cells are locally renewed and independent of hematopoiesis for the first time. So in the field of cancer immunology, Mariam is known by her work that identified the CD103DC and this important role in anti-tumor immunity. So more recently this year, her lab actually identified another new subset of dendritic cells. They named matured regulatory DC that actually can control the efficacy of immune checkpoint blockade. To recognize her incredible contribution to science, she was elected as a member of National Academy of Science and received multiple awards, including the William Colley Award for Distinguished Research in Basic Immunology. Now, as a follower of her research, I'm really looking forward to learn from her more about like how myelocells can impact on immunotherapy.
Thank you very much for this nice introduction. It's a pleasure to be here, really, and it's a pleasure to have James to talk again with Zihai, who I've known for a long time. So thank you for the invitation, Zihai, to join the Scientific Advisory Board, and it's my pleasure to talk today about our work on I need to share my screen first. Share. Okay. So our work on the rational search for myeloid targets to enhance therapeutic anti-tumor immunity. So as Tony mentioned, the checkpoint blockade has really transformed cancer treatment landscape, and this has led to a significant expansion of immuno-oncology drug target. There is now more than 4,000 immuno-oncology therapy in the global drug development worldwide. This is a 22% increase compared to 2019, a 233% increase compared to 2017. And it seems that there is no competitor really to the PD-1 and PD-L1 checkpoints. And clearly, you know, this checkpoint therapy, while very successful, are leaving, you know, millions of patients out. So there is clearly a need to enhance scientific rationale to guide immuno-oncology in combination, or to also enhance the discovery of relevant immuno-oncology targets. So we have learned a lot about the mechanisms that really control durable response to checkpoint blockades. For example, we have learned that high tumor mutation burden, high infiltration of T cells, the presence of tertiary lymphoid structure at the tumor site correlate with tumor response to checkpoint blockade. We have also learned that, in fact, the CD28B7 pathway, and I think this is maybe less really emphasized in the literature, but we've learned from two interesting studies, maybe more than that, that CD28B7 pathway regulates T cell response to checkpoint. So for example, let's say Scamhorst, when she was a postdoc in Rafi Ahmed's lab, showed that CD28 expression is required for T cell proliferation upon PD-1 blockade, both in mice and in humans. And now Ron Verl and Ira Melman have shown that PD-1 suppresses T cell function primarily by inactivating CD28 signaling. And now CD28 is mostly engaged by CD80 and 86, which are expressed mainly by antigen-presenting cells. Now there's also more recent data that suggests that T cell spatial interaction with LPC correlate with intratumoral T cell infiltration and also correlate with reduced relapse after surgery in several different cancer type. And we had shown in mice that DC1 is required for tumor response to checkpoint blockade. So, and yet, you know, despite probably a prominent role of APC, you know, in modulating tumor response to checkpoint, APC cellular and molecular features that are conducive to effective T cell responses upon immunotherapy are really not really known. So there are two main APCs in most tissue, and these APCs are present in the steady state prior to any injury, and these include both macrophages and dendritic cells. So really to learn about the molecular features of these APCs in cancer lesions, we started really a major effort to really learn in an unbiased manner, as unbiased as possible, but the molecular program of APC in cancer lesions. So we focused on treatment naive, early stage, non-small cell lung cancer lesions. We've looked at 35 patients. We looked at both the APC feature in the tumor and adjacent tissue using single-cell RNA sequencing of purified CD45 positive cells. CD45 is expressed on all hematopoietic cells, so you should be able to capture the majority of hematopoietic cells in this tissue. We've analyzed 500,000 CD45 positive cells. It's a huge number of cells, probably the largest effort, I think, in the world today. This is why, you know, funding is critical, and this way I'm constantly broke. And we've analyzed 137,000 cells using site sequencing. And CiteSeq is a method that allows to stain cells with antibodies that are linked to an oligonucleotide prior to putting the cells on a single cell sequencer. So now you can learn about the antibody profile and also and learn of molecular profile at the single cell level. And antibody is quite important, especially when you study T cells, because you can then introduce prior knowledge, which was mostly gained by antibody profiling, to help annotate the cluster. So what we of cells that share the same molecular program. So here in CND, I show you the first unbiased clustering analysis that identifies cells that share the same transcript. So if they share the same transcript, they share the same program. And so above here on the high level plot, it's RNA transcript. Lower level is the antibody profile. And then we integrate these two types of analysis to really annotate the cluster. And to annotate the cluster, we use prior knowledge. Then we look at the distribution of this cluster in the tumor and the adjacent tissue. And one of the first things we've done is then measure really this, the this cluster landscape with what has been published in the literature. And I think it's an important exercise. There was a question for Tony on can we really expand the result that we obtain from our data set. And this is, I think, important to realize that we can mine public data set quite easily. And now it becomes quite, you know, interesting and important to compare, you know, our finding with that of other laboratory. And I was very excited to see that in terms of cluster composition and frequency seems to match very much, you know, some of the publicly available data set. For example, this one published by Lambrecht et al. Using the same technology to profile also adenocarcinoma lesions, but this study was done by a different lab and lab, you know, in Belgium. Now, the second experiment, the second analysis we've done is to look at heterogeneity of this tumor compared to heterogeneity across different tumor lesions. And this is also important because heterogeneity is very now, you know, highlighted. And what we found is, in fact, there is much less heterogeneity within a tumor lesion than compare and then in between tumor lesions, suggesting that maybe we could treat a tumor. Here we're looking not in great detail, but we're looking at cell at cluster frequency. Doesn't seem there's much changes. So in this study, what they've done is they biopsy three different tumor regions, and the three different tumor regions was analyzed by single cell sequencing. So we've looked at the distribution of our own cluster that we identify in this study across these three different tumor regions analyzed by a different group, and we saw there was first a lot of commonality and a lot of commonality between the regions. And then we've done another analysis, now in our own study, where we compared the viability of this immune cluster that we identify between a tumor and the adjacent tissue within one patient. This is what we look at, and we measure them by these occlusion distance differences between, you know, differences between adjacent tissue, differences across different patients, differences between different tumor tissue across different patients, or differences between the tumor versus the adjacent tissue and within patients. And what was very, very clear is that there are much more differences between the tumor and the adjacent tissue within one same patient than between different tumors. Of course, there are differences between different tumor lesions, but there are also a lot of commonality. And this is not surprising because the PD-1 pathway, for example, is common to many patients, also common to different cancer types. Okay, so this is, I think, quite reassuring. Heterogeneity exists, but there are commonality between these different tumor sites, and there are a lot of commonality between different tumor lesions. Okay, so now I'm going to focus on our recent data on DC molecular features in human lung cancer lesions. So here I'm showing you really a scheme of dendritic cells origin and ontogeny, and many of these was identified by my group, but many other groups in the world, in fact. So we now know that in most tissue in the steady state is populated by two types of dendritic cells, DC1 and DC2. These two DCs arise from a common DC precursor, which is a DC restricted precursor that arise from the common myeloid progenitors in the bone marrow. In the steady state, there is an additional population that accumulate in the injured site, which derive from monocyte. We and others have shown that these three different dendritic cell populations have distinct molecular program and can have different weight on T cell activation. And it is now clear from data by our group, but many other groups, that DC1, this subset of dendritic cells, which require the you know, a very unique transcription factor differentiation program, is very well equipped to cross-present cell-associated antigen to CD8 T cells. and therefore, you know, their role in potentially anti-tumor and antiviral immunity is now really emphasized, hence, you know, the focus of cancer immunology is to identify potential ways to really enhance DC1 functionality in lesions. But before enhancing DC function, the first thing we wanted to know is to understand the molecular features of these dendritic cells, and first, you know, all the dendritic cell population in tumor lesion, and this is what I'm showing you here. So using the single cell RNA sequencing approach, we now identify, we were able to recognize all these dendritic cell population, the DC1, DC2, and this monocyte-derived dendritic cells, and we recognize them based on their transcriptional program, but also antibody expression profile. And then we quantify the distribution of this DC population in the tumor and in the adjacent tissue. And what we saw is there was a constant reduction of DC1 in the tumor lesion. This is true in all the cancer lesions that we've analyzed, and it's also true in mice tumor lesions. Okay, so we had, in fact, suggested many years ago that maybe the paucity of dendritic cells in tumor lesions was really an impediment to really enhance CD8 T cell or to promote optimal anti-tumor CD8 T cell immunity. And here, you know, to really address this question, what we did is we now deleted DC1. I should have showed you the mouse model in particular, but okay. So when we had this data that I just showed you here in human, you know, how do you really transfer this data to mice? And to do this, what we have used is this lung cancer model that was developed by Tyler Jacks, in which he uses an adenocarcinoma. We use an adenocarcinoma line that derived from his genetically engineered mouse model that expresses a KRAS mutation and p53 deletion. We also enforced GFP expression in this line and injected into mice, and the mice formed really a clinically a human lesion that quite resembled the human adenocarcinoma lesions. And here, prior to injection of this tumor graft, what we did is we deleted DC1 in mice, and when we deleted DC mice, what we saw, so there's no treatment here, we just delete DC1. And what we saw, there was a very strong acceleration of tumor progression in these mice, which was quite a bit surprising because we were not treating in any way. But what we saw is that this deletion was also associated with deletion of DC1, which in fact didn't affect at all DC2 or macrophage or B cell compartment. It was sufficient to really enhance tumor progression, but it was also associated with a very strong reduction of CD8 positive T cells producing interferon gamma and TNF in the tumor lesion. So suggesting that DC1 was probably shaping, you know, T cell accumulation at the tumor site. And remember, I've discussed in my first slide that the accumulation of presence of T cell in tumor lesions is a very good biomarker of tumor response to checkpoint blockade. And what we also saw now conversely, is that expansion of DC1 using also genetic manipulation that we had developed in collaboration with Boris Rice many years ago, where here by fluxing P10 in dendritic cells, we see a substantial expansion of DC1 in tumor lesions. Here, on the contrary, we saw a reduction of tumor growth and an expansion of CD8 T cell. So indeed suggesting that DC1 shape the tumor microenvironment. It's important to remember that when we think about, you know, what are the determinants of a tumor response to checkpoint. So the question that we had is, can we really enhance, if these DCs are able to shape CD8 T cells, can we enhance their functionality in tumor lesions? So there we went back and, you know, we've looked at, I discussed with you the composition of dendritic cell population in tumor versus adjacent tissue. I showed you that DC1 are present in reduced number in tumor lesion. But now the question is that, are their molecular program modified, affected by the tumor? Okay, so this is what we've looked at here. So first, if we look at DC1 in tumor or adjacent tissue, we saw very little differences, in fact, in terms of molecular program. They look like the one present in the adjacent tissue. But what we identify is this presence of an additional cluster. And here I'm not talking about subset, right? Clusters are cells that share the same transcript. And this is what we call here, this is what I call DC, because I didn't know how to name it at that time. And this cluster expresses many maturation markers, including CD40, 80, and 86, express also, however, many regulatory markers, including PD-L1, you know, you can see here to the roof compared to DC1 and DC2, PD-L2, FAS, LDHL12, which is known to control retinoic acid metabolism and potentially affect Treg development, lot of SOX, expression of SOX protein, which is known to really dampen cytokine signaling. So what's interesting is that this group of cells also have a strong reduction of toll-like receptor expression, so they completely dampen toll-like receptor expression as if they don't want to be able to sense anymore. And they also express very high level of transcript associated with migration, such as CCR7, for example, and fascia. And because the cells express a lot of maturation and regulatory molecule, we call them mature DC enriched in immunoregulatory molecule, or MREG DC. Okay, so then we ask whether, so this was identified in human lung adenocarcinoma that I introduced earlier in my talk, and we wanted to know whether the same group of cells or DC cluster was also present in other human cancer lesions. So this is a profile that we profiling a huge number, also a large number of liver cancer lesions that we have recently finalized in the laboratory. These are the phenomenal scientists that worked in this project. And here, very similarly to what we found in the human lung adenocarcinoma lesions, we were able to detect exactly this DC cluster with exactly the same molecular profile, right? This is a DC that we have not been used to see in tissue. And in fact, so we went back and asked whether the same MREG DC were also present in mouse cancer lesion, mouse lung cancer lesion that I introduced to you. And so we use also single cell RNA sequencing to profile the lung cancer associated myeloid program. And we found in mice, similar in human, the presence of this DC1, DC2, but also this MREG DC cluster. And I have to say it's very, in fact, easier to work on DC and go back and forth between mice and human than doing the same exercise in macrophage, where the similarity between the mouse and human cluster are not as great. Here, you know, to the gene level, you know, you can find similarity. So it's really facilitate any functional studies on dendritic cells population. Now, this signature of dendritic cells have been described, in fact, have been described by my group in collaboration with the InGen consortia, where we have performed the, using microarray at that time, you know, in 2012, a very large effort to use, to study, in fact, the expression profile of myeloid cells across, you know, the mouse body. And we had identified, in fact, what we had called at that time a migratory DC signature. So we showed that in the tissue, there was these two DC subsets, DC1 and DC2, but in the lymph node, the migratory DC seems to express this migratory DC signature that we have identified in the tissue. And we had said at that time that both DC1 and DC2 could upregulate this migratory DC signature when they reach the lymph node. And we thought that the signature may have been induced upon migration to the draining lymph node. So to ask whether migration was in fact inducing these molecular changes, what we did is we've done exactly the same experiment in mice that lack CCR7, which prevent DC migration to the draining lymph node. And then we looked at and also prevent DC, in fact, engagement in lymphatic vessels at the tissue site. And we saw that CCR7 deletion did not affect at all the expression of this MREG DC genotype. And so migration was not really inducing this molecular program. Now, we were quite intrigued by the fact that, you know, when we looked at this CDC cluster, you know, whether this was a different subset of dendritic cell or whether it was, in fact, a molecular program induced in DC1 and DC2. And this is why I think it's important to really follow what I'm going to say now, because it is, we have not identified a new subset. When we now look at our CiteSeq results, so CiteSeq is a way where we profile with antibody. Now, we use antibody to mark DC1 and DC2, and then we bring the cells to a sequencer. And what we saw is that both DC1 and DC2 were able to express this MREG DC molecular signature. Both of them express it. Now, there are some differences between DC1 and DC2 that express MREG DC. For example, the DC1 are the only one that express IL-12 beta chain when develop this MREC phenotype. Whereas the MREC-DC2, for example, express higher level of SOX2, but they share a very large molecular program. Now remember, by single cell sequencing, we can only identify the most expressed gene. So it's possible that something happened in this DC1 and DC2 that lead to a very strong, in fact, modulation of the transcriptional program and the identity gene. So for example, the CD103, was in fact diluted in this polycular program and we couldn't capture it. But by protein level, the protein was still expressed, we are now able to see that both DC1 and DC2 express this program. So what induced this MREC-DC phenotype? So the question we ask is whether capture of cell-associated antigen was in fact induced this MREC phenotype. And to ask this question, what we did is we now injected again, these tumor lesions that express GFP, and we purified dendritic cells that express GFP or the dendritic cells that do not express GFP. Okay? And now you may remember that the cells expressed also the cells, the MREC-DC expressed a lot of migratory molecule. So most of them were in the draining lymph node, and it's possible that the GFP positive dendritic cell that we capture in the tumor site are those that have recently captured tumor antigen. And then we ask whether this GFP-positive DC were enriched in this MREC-DC phenotype. And indeed, that was exactly the case. In fact, there was a complete concordance between the GFP-positive DC and the expression of MREC-DC. It was really strongly enriched in cells that have recently captured tumor antigen. Okay? Now, and we validated that at the protein level, you can see that GFP positive DC expressed very high level of PD-L1, it's expressed very high level of CD40, and this is not the case for GFP negatives. Also expressed high level of IL-12. This is here gated on DC1. Now we ask whether we could induce this MREC phenotype in vitro. And here, and it was an important experiment because in vivo, you don't know what the differentiation state of the DC that you are going to identify. So it's possible that DC that eat are also, in fact, differentiating into this MREC phenotype. So here, what we did is we now use bone marrow derived dendritic cells culture in this new culture system that was developed by Boris Rices to generate mostly DC. One or DC2. And then we feed them with KPGFP and we ask whether these cells that have eaten are enriched in this MREC-DC phenotype. And this is the case again. So it seems that when you eat, where you are a DC1 or a DC2, you now differentiate into this MREC-DC. Okay? So what we showed, I think, and I think it's an important finding that the MREC-DC state identify really the tumor antigen charged DC, which is really analogous to the tumor antigen specific T cells, right? So MREC-DC, therefore, are uniquely able to shape, I would say, antigen specific T cell immunity, right? So it's a way of really focusing our attention to the DC that matters. So focusing on the MREC-DC program should help identify relevant pathway for the modulation of antigen-specific T-cell immunity. Remember, I started the talk by saying, okay, so what combination matter here? What combination of molecule will enhance T-cell immunity? Here, what we identify is a molecular program that is induced upon DC, upon tumor antigen uptake, and that will also lead to DC migration to the draining lymph node. And this is why these cells are really highly enriched in migration, is because when they eat, there is a molecular program that will link antigen uptake and antigen migration, which we are looking into in terms of molecular control of this, that link eating and migration to the draining lymph node. Now I want to show you this recent experiment that we've done in collaboration with the Ido Amitz lab. So Ido Amitz lab now developed a new technique. I don't know what I'm doing in terms of time. I have to look at maybe the chat here. am I doing well in terms of time or no?
I think it's fine. We have some time. Yeah.
Okay. All right. So I should have three slides left. So here, what Ito did is he developed, and Merav Cohen, who was a postdoc in his lab and spent a lot of time in my lab. So what Merav did is that she purified, in fact, doublet cells from different tissue sites in this paper that she published in Nature Biotech, and then sequenced these doublet cells at the single cell level. And she defined this technology as PIC-seq, and as a technology that allows to really understand the molecular program of interacting cells, so physically interacting cells. And now, you know, you can argue that how is it possible to really isolate physiologically relevant, physically interacting cells? Well, I invite you to look at this paper because I was very doubtful of this technology, but still invited Merav to work in my lab. And what we did with Merav is now use the same technology to now purify doublet cells in human lung cancer lesions. And the type of doublet that we wanted to look at are doublet cells that express both T cell marker and myeloid marker. And then we ask, this is what we do here. So we purify these doublet cells, quite crazy, because you think these are, usually we discarded them in all our analysis. Here we are going to purify them and we put them on these plates that Ido was going to sequence. And then we are going to look at what myeloid program is enriched in the doublet compared to the single cells, right? And what we saw is that there was a very strong enrichment of MRGDC in this doublet. T myeloid cells at the tumor site. Very much like we predicted that MRGDC are charged with antigen and are the ones that are going to interact with T cells. So this suggests, and you can see here that DC1 are strongly reduced. In fact, they are depleted in these physically interacting cells, whether it's at the tumor site or at the normal site. So this suggests that these MRGDC are the cells that capture antigen and interact with T cells. Now, why this is important? It's important because here we were able to resolve at the single cell level, very distinct and opposite, right, molecular program. So the same cells is going to be able to activate T cells, but also regulate it. It express high level of CD40, high level of 80, high level of 86, but also high level of PD-L1. Before the single cell time, we will call the cell expressing a lot of PD-L1 and PD-L2 the tolerogenic DC, and the one with a lot of activation, the activating DC. Here I'm showing you that both exist in the same cell. And this suggests that by understanding the transcriptional program that lead to immunoregulation versus those that leads to immunostimulation, we will be, we could potentially really shift, right, and enhance DC functionality in lesion. So I'm going to show you an example of what I mean by this. So for example, we saw a very strong, in fact, expression of a Th2 response in this MRGDC, whether they were DC1 or DC2. And this included the expression of alpha receptor alpha, alpha-I1, CCL17, CCL22, etc. Okay, so we ask whether this Th2 response can dampen DC1 function, and we first looked at it in vitro, and indeed, we saw that upon uptake of tumor antigen, this DC1 expressed high level of IL-4 receptor alpha that can respond to IL-4, and addition of IL-4 in vitro dampened, in fact, CD40 expression, dampened IL-12 expression. All right, so we...
Sorry to interrupt you, but we are run out of time.
Okay, this is my last slide then.
Okay.
The IL-4 blockade, what we show is that IL-4 blockade was indeed able to enhance DC1 function and also reduce tumor growth. Maybe not only by modulating DC, but definitely we saw an enhanced T-cell activation locally. Okay, I'm going to stop by saying this, is that it is really this this balance between APC molecular stimulatory and regulatory program that is going to really determine, in fact, T cell activation. And in addition, so this is the term of balance that we are looking at now in tumor lesion. There's another level of balance, which is in terms of APC composition, which I didn't have time to talk about, just the balance of DC versus macrophage, for example. But by understanding, in fact, IPC molecular feature, I believe that we'll be able to really strongly modulate T cell activation and T cell effector function at the tumor site. Okay, so thank you very much, and I'm sorry if I was a bit late.
All right. Thank you so much for the excellent talk and the very elegant study. So we do have a lot of questions from the audience. So I think one have Benjamin Seagal is that what is the molecular pathway by which uptake of tumor antigen drive this, mature regulatory DC development? Does this is also occur with the non-tumor antigen? This is also my part of my question, is that is this specific to tumor or self-antigen? Is that also happen in infection?
Yeah, okay, so that's a very important question. And the same program, when I described it earlier in the mouse studies that we've done, that was all done in healthy mice, and healthy mice that, at steady state. And we now have verified that the same program exists also in normal lung, whether it's human or mice lung. So this occurs, this MRGDC phenotype exists upon uptake of cell-associated antigen. And it is emphasized, it is increased when you enhance the cell antigen cargo, right? If you have more cells, cell-associated antigen to uptake, you will see now the accumulation of MRGDC, and this is why potentially we didn't see it before. Of course, we were not using single cell approaches. Now, what triggers that is the big question we're looking at right now. I can tell you we spend a lot of money and a lot of time trying to identify, what is driving it. What I can tell you is that there is a core program, which, I don't know what's driving that core program. There, the cytokine release and some of these other molecules. So for example, IL-12 beta production by DC1 is absolutely induced by interferon gamma. And not interferon gamma produced by T cell, but likely by NK cells. Because in RAG mice, we see the same MRGDC phenotype. So there is part of the program that is, a mixture of cues that we are trying to decipher right now, and it's going to occupy us for some time. I know that several groups are looking at this, and I'm glad. And I think it's going to be interesting to identify, what triggers it. So we are very focusing now on phagocytosis and how phagocytosis is triggering it, and what phagocytic receptors matters the most.
Okay, all right. I think continue to that question. So I think I have another question related to that is, what is the role of TRR in this?
So, okay, yeah.
Did you see more this regulatory DC if we use like a MYO-ADA knockout mice?
So in fact, not at all. MYD88 TRIF IL-1 receptor has no effect on this MRGDC phenotype. However, I'm quite interested in following why these TOR-like receptor, are strongly reduced, right? And what happened if we enforce TOR-like receptor expression in this MRGDC. So that would be interesting. But right now, the phenotype, the molecular genotype that we found was not affected at all by MYD88 signaling.
Okay, we have one more question. So I think Kenshin Yan said, do you know if this regular disease process and present the same epitope for a given antigen, for example, like immunoproteins or proteins?
Yeah. Okay, so question. So I think what I'm saying is that all DC, the conventional DC, upon uptake will become MREG. It's not a different subset. So they eat and they acquire this phenotype. And I'm just calling them MREG. We can call them DC1 MREG. It's just a molecular state. So yes, I think they are going to use all the conventional antigen processing machinery. It's just I'm defining a state so that instead of looking at DC1 and what they express in terms of their modulation marker, we are now going to look at this MREG DC and really understand, based on their state, what's probably going to determine T cell, I was going to say effector function, but T cell molecular program. right? So it is exactly the same cell type that is just in a different molecular state.
All right, thank you very much for your answer and thank you everyone's time. So now we're gonna take a 4-minute break, come back at 2:20 for the rest of talk.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. It is my great pleasure to introduce next Dr. Christian Jobin. Dr. Christian Jobin is the Gatorade Trust Professor of Medicine at the University of Florida, Gainesville. He is the co-leader of the Cancer Therapeutics and Host Response Research Program at the University of Florida Health Cancer Center. He received his PhD in immunology and microbiology from University of Laval, and he has also completed his postdoctoral fellowship at the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill, working on bacterial host interactions in the intestine. Dr. Jobin's research focuses on establishing the functional impact of bacteria in inflammation and carcinogenesis and deciphering the mechanisms of action. His laboratory showed key role of genotoxic microbial gene clusters in the development of carcinogenesis, and he has also demonstrated the influence of inflammation on intestinal microbial carcinogenic activities and has contributed to the understanding of the cellular and molecular mechanisms of regulating host response to bacterial colonization. Dr. Jobin has published numerous papers on innate signaling events taking place in the intestine and how this impacts intestinal homeostasis. He has received numerous awards and honors, including Mucosal Immunology Society Award, American Gastroenterological Association Friedman Young Investigator Basic Research Award and the UF Senior Faculty of Excellence in Research Award. Dr. Jobin, thank you for being here, and we really look forward to your talk titled Improving Anti-Tumor Therapy Response Through Microbiota.
Thank you so much, Maria. Thank you. I'm going to start this. I'm running with my phone so that you have the right pointers. All right, it's working. Good. I'm very humbled to share the stage with such a distinguished set of speakers. So thank you for the invitation. And I'm a little bit an outsider here because I bring microbes into the equation, but I understand that you will appreciate this relationship with immunology and microbiology. Disclosure, here they are. They have no effect or influence on the content of what I'm going to talk today. So this is a tree with branches. At the root of the tree is intestinal microbiota. It's just to illustrate that there's a lot of diseases where investigators have looked at case and control in terms of microbiome and genomic experimental driven design. And they look at differences between case and control. And you could see that many diseases have a different microbiome if you're healthy versus hypertension, asthma, PDAC, diabetes, and so on. Even our beloved COVID that now has one cohort, and we're working on that as well. And so there is a link between microbes and different diseases. A lot of these studies are correlative. Some have a little bit more depth of understanding, but nevertheless, there's enough information out there to action, to put investigator into a therapeutic mode, if you will. And this is a scheme cartoon that illustrates what has been doing right now in terms of therapeutics, targeting the microbes. So the blue purple arrows is intervention on the microbiome. The red are harvesting information from the microbiome. I'm not going to go through everything. I like to focus on this arrow, drug interaction with the microbiome. What I'm going to discuss with you today stems from two different drug, I guess, right? Anti-inflammatory agent for colorectal cancer and immune checkpoint inhibitor for non-small cell lung carcinoma. So two different, I guess, two different thematic in the lecture. So let's go with colorectal cancer. I want to use this scheme here just to illustrate work that we have done in that space, but also incorporate concept from the literature. So we know for sure that luminal and mucosal associated biome engage the host with different cells. So if you think about the gut, there will be epithelial cells, immune cells underneath, and all these cells have been somehow educated by the biome. And at the same time, through this exposure, the host react and tone this interaction so that you have a healthy relationship here that we all have in our gut right now, most of us that are healthy. So this is a very important set of education, transcommunication that set up a productive interaction. There is unfortunately modifier that come to play that disrupt this healthy conversation. And these modifiers could be designed as inflammatory of nature, diet, medication, not less, well, to a certain degree genetics, but it's not the main driving force. So these modifiers, as a consequence, will change the biome into a different composition. So it comes some sort of erosion of the microbes as the healthy state been exposed to these modifiers. So you could have these modifications at the planktonic level, but also at the mucosal associated level. So the organization is different. Through this organization disruption, there will be what we call a microbiome carcinogenic network that could be formed with a consequence that there will be neoplastic changes throughout the exposure. Which kind of microbiome or microbial carcinogenic network? I'll give you some example here. You will have small molecule produced by some enterobacteriaceae, and these small molecule, one small molecule is called colibactin, hydrogen sulfide producing bacteria, cytolithal distancing toxin as well, B. fragilis toxin. So different component that form some sort of a carcinogenic soup that impact on the host. And these molecules don't act in silos. They sometimes coexist, and there's publication that have shown that the small molecule cutibactin could enter or synergize with B. fragilis toxin to enhance colorectal cancer. And that gives the concept that this is a complex disease that involves microbial component as well as obviously genetics, host genetics. I have a lot of questions when I talk about microbiome and cancer. And I said, how does it work? Could you give us an example? How do microbes promote cancer? So I like to focus on this small molecule cutibactin just to give you some sort of clarity into how that could be conducive of cancer. So cutibactin is the end product of a pathway, and it's encoded by an island called polyketide synthase island, PKS. It has 19 genes, and it's a assembly of, it encodes different enzyme and structural protein, and that's happening in the cytosol of some bacteria, like some E. coli, for example. The end product is a prodrug, so it's called pre-colibactin. It's a long tail, long molecule. And we know that the island is coming with its own enzyme here, CLBP. And this enzyme is in the inner plasm of the bacteria with the enzyme facing the inside the periplasm. And this enzyme is responsible for activating the colibactin. But we have a problem. The assembly happened in the cytosol. So how do you solve that? Well, there's a molecule that is coming from the molecule. It's a transporter that is coming from the island called CLBM. And this, we've shown, is responsible for moving the colibactin, a pre-colibactin, inside the periplasm. Now you have this complex molecule that could interface with the enzyme responsible for the cleavage asparagine in the molecule. And it will give this beautiful compound that has been solved last year, a beautiful compound that you could see the cyclopropane warhead on both sides. It's symmetrical molecule. And that molecule, we don't know how, but somehow may be encountering a host through a mechanism here of release that is not clear. That molecule could be interacting with mammalian DNA if the bacteria is close to an epithelial cells, and it caused these interstrain crosslink at adenine, and that has been shown to recent publication. So this is in one example of how complex a small molecule produced by bacteria could interact and damage your DNA that puts you at higher risk of cancer. So that's like 14 years of work. So there's a lot of blood and sweat that was put into that to understand how this colibactin and molecule could cause cancer. We still have a lot of outstanding questions. Why produce colibactin? We don't have the answer to that. What regulates colibactin production? The mechanism of genotoxicity is somehow known, but it's coming from the bug, not the small molecule. Mechanism of protection, how did the bug protect itself? And mutational landscape, actually this, there was a set of reviewers that were asking us back in 2011 when we submit our paper linking colibactin to cancer. They was asking, show us genes that are mutated by this colibactin. So it was a little bit of a bigger quest than what the paper was showing. So we could not answer that question. And it was a little bit out of scope. Wow. Now, 8 years later, someone answered that question. So this two recent paper was published from the lab of Hans Clevers and also the lab of Thomas Mayer, Nature Medicine and Nature. I'll focus on the Clevers publication because we cover it. So I like to use cartoons that we make. So this is a colonocyte, a human colonocyte. And what these folks have done is to inject a PKS positive E. coli or PKS negative as a control and done chronic exposure to the colonocyte over 5 months, and they sequence the DNA of these colonocyte and found that the mutation was single base substitution. Again, remember I said adenine cross-linking. So these two adenine are cross-linked and it caused this single base substitution or a short indel insertion deletion if you have a polytamine stretch. So these two molecular signature of mutation, when they got that from human, they went into whole genome sequencing in the database, and they were able to analyze and found the mutational signature in a small percent of colorectal cancer, either that metastasize or from the origin of colorectal cancer. So the mutational signature is found in human. The bug is found in human. In animal models show the cancer, the role of PKS in cancer. So we kind of narrowed the gap into what does it mean to have this bug in your gut? Potentially, it could develop cancer. That's pretty much what we could say here. Now, if I go back to this cartoon, all right, I showed to you that what we believe is forming when you have a microbiome that has been assaulted and eroded by a different modifier, you have this microbial carcinogenic network forming with example here. So the question we were asking, if inflammation is one of the modifier, is there a way to interfere with this inflammation that will prevent this erosion of microbiome? And for that, we use an anti-TNF, something that has been used in the clinic for rheumatoid arthritis, IBD, and psoriasis. So you have Remicade, and we decided to do that with the help of a talented postdoc, Ye Yang, in the lab. So the simple model is an EPC min mouse, but if you, this is mostly small bowel, but if you expose that mouse to a chemical called DSS, it has inflammation in the gut and it promotes cancer in the colon. So it's a very simple model. So we expose the mouse to antibiotics to make room from the NC101, which carry the PKS island. So it's a colibactin producer, expose the mouse to DSS, and after that intervene with the anti-TNF 6 doses and look at 35 days later. And what we could see is that the anti-TNF decreased tumor, number of tumors per colon in the mouse, not very surprising. And this is the image of that result here. Now, the thing that we could do when you have a mouse over time is that you collect microbiome or specimen feces and we study composition. And this is the red and blue dots, the control or the anti-TNF. This is the mouse cohort before you intervene on it. And it's the same genetic background. So you don't expect to see any differences in the distribution of red and blue, right? The microbiome of all of these mice are the same because they are the same background. Now, when you at day 14, look at the stools of these mouse. So this is after the third injection of TNF, you could see a separation getting happening between blue and red. And the 35 days is at the end, and you see a very nice separation. Remember, this is individual microbiome of individual mouse, okay? So the entire biome. And the colon tissue as well show this nice separation. So something is happening in the gut of these mouse as they are receiving TNF. We look at the transcriptome, and this transcriptome was normalized from a whole genome metagenome. We have make sure that there's no bias because the bugs are changing and the gene may change. So we normalize for the gene content. And you could see the difference between red and blue. This is a transcriptomic level, again, at day 14 or day 35. So the composition and the gene output transcriptomic-wise is changing once you have TNF in the environment, anti-TNF. Now, a reason why we have less tumors in these mice treated with anti-TNF is because maybe you have a decrease of the bugs producing the molecule that cause cancer. Simple explanation. But when you look at you culture the bugs or you look at genomics, so this is whole genome metagenome looking at NC101, there's no differences over time, even if you have control of anti-TNF. So the answer is not that you have less bacteria. Looking at the microbiome transcriptome, again, at day 14 or 35. This is the heat map between control anti-TNF. Most of the day 14 biome transcriptome is decreased except these two pathways, degradation of aromatic compound, filin and alin metabolism. And at day 35, it's mostly a decrease. In pink is our pathways that we found also downregulated by anti-TNF in human IBD patient. So there is some overlap with the response, either if your microbes living in the gut of an IBD patient exposed to anti-TNF or a mouse. Now, does it mean anything that you have change of microbiome in the context of anti-TNF? So here, the reason that we did this experiment is because these mice are co-housed, so they could share their feces through a natural habit they have, which is coprophagy. So now that you transfer passively microbes from one cohort exposed to TNF or PBS, you will be able to answer if there's difference of response. And now you see that the anti-TNF, even though the mouse, every mice there received the anti-TNF, there is no difference in the, there's no difference in cancer number of tumors. So there is a alleviation, attenuation of the response. And you look at the red and blue dots that I've mentioned before. Now there's no separation whatsoever throughout the time and in the tissue as well. So the microbiome did not change, and the biome did not change, correlates with lack of TNF effect on the anti-cancer. Could you carry this phenotype? So the question here is, if I change the biome of mouses treated with anti-TNF and I transfer this biome into a fresh cohort that never received the treatment, will you carry the phenotype? Is the biome memorizing the anti-TNF effect and the impact on cancer development? The answer is yes. The anti-TNF treated biome implanted in a new cohort has less capacity to develop or promote cancer than the non-treated one. So you carry the memory, and the plasticity of the biome is influenced by the TNF. So a little bit here, a simplistic version of what I've said. You have an inflammation exposure that changed the biome. And again, you have this carcinogenic network been promoted, established. And this is not forever. You could intervene on that. For example, the anti-TNF reversed these changes and collapsed this capacity of biome to induce cancer. Now, going back to my cartoon, I said that I'd like to talk also with immune checkpoint inhibitor, and that will be my segue into that now. And this is a cartoon that illustrates landmark papers. It was published in two years ago, 2018. And what these folks have done is to look at the biome of PD-1 responder and non-responder patient. And what they found, there is a different biome composition in these folks. So functionally, they wanted to test that. They implanted tumors in the mouse and also transferred the feces from a responder or non-responder to a fresh cohort, treated the mice with PD-1 blockade, and look for response. And they could see that the responder, the mouse harboring the responder biome, has a higher CD8 infiltrating T cells, cytotoxic T cell, versus the non-responder are mostly CD4 Treg, for example. So you carry the responsiveness with the biome into a new system. So these studies were done with MD Anderson, Chicago, and Gustave Roussy. And it was all the study were aligned to the same outcome, increase responsiveness with a specific set of macros. The signature of the responsible macros, for example, is different between cohort. Right. So that was one thing that was striking. You don't overlap the signal and it's not clear how it works. And we were intrigued by that. And we wanted to have our own cohort here. So Gustave Roussy, I've done a non-small cell lung cancer cohort. The other one did melanoma. So we wanted to look at the non-small cell lung cancer in North America. We partnered with Moffitt, and this is what we did. Recruited 64 patients, baseline, follow up 34 of them. Look at microbiome composition in responder, non-responder, as defined by RECIST criteria. Christine Pierce assembled this cohort, and Rachel Newsom in the lab did all the wet bench study. And what we did is look at microbiome, again, diversity and all the composition. And the durable response two versus two, you could see that there is a difference between non-responder, responder, long-term response as well, and extreme responder. So what does this mean? Doesn't mean much, there's differences. You need to do the functional experiment. So we kind of repeated what folks have done. Pull a responder biome from these patient and also non-responder, introduce them into a germ-free mouse. So now you have a humanized microbiome mouse recipient. And this is in germ-free, so we know that they were not contaminated by any other bugs because they are kept in these isolator. So this is humanized with no interference with outside world. And just this typical experiment, 2 weeks colonization to make sure the biome is established, fecal collection, then implantation of Lewis lung carcinoma cells, wait for defined size of tumors, inject PD-1, and then sac and look for a response. And this is the curve of growth. So you could see that the mouse that received a responding microbiome exposed to anti-PD-1 have a better anti-tumor or lowest growth than the responder that was the non-responder that was exposed to PD-1. So there's a difference in tumors. We look at tumor volume as well and tumor weight. This is quick. This is unpublished, so it's not exactly drilled down. We look at different immune cell infiltration and cytokines. This is just an example. Interleukin 17A is lower in the responder versus non-responder in correlation with tumor size as well. So there is a change in the immune microenvironment. What happened to the microbiota? Now, this is interesting. I use this illustration here. So this is the patient that are responder, 4 patients, and the pool of these patients. Okay, and now the same with non-responder, we had 6 and the pool of these. We use the pool to populate the mouse. So the biome is different between responder and non-responder. And when you implant them in the mouse, you could see that there is a very stark differences in their biome. So they stay different as they get into the mouse. We dropped 60% of the human biome, so only 40% implanted if you compare it with the original inoculum, because a mouse is a mouse. A mouse have a different diet, different lifestyle, so you don't expect to have 100% overlap. But it's a nice natural filtering of your microbiome if you have a phenotype, which we have. Now we look at the, what we did here is the same microbiome differences, but this time we also plot with the tumor. I'm moving too fast here. Okay. This is the biome plot against tumor weight. So the smaller the node, the less tumor weight. And then you could see that you have an impact. And a non-responder are a different microbiome, and they tend to have larger tumor weight. This is a little bit of a high resolution view, but at genius level. And what you have here is above the red line is enriched in responder, below the red line enriched in the non-responder. And look at the genus. All this is done at the ASV, not OTU level. So this, all these are different species. So within the genus, some are associated with non-responder and other with responder. So you need a lot of resolution to sort out who is doing what in this cohort, for example. It's pretty rare you have a unique species that is driving the response.
So we're running a little over.
I'm done. So,
okay.
I'm sorry about that. This is the tumor size and this is the species. And what we wanted to do is to look at distribution of these microorganisms. And family-wise, we were able to identify 2 families of Staphylococcus that associate with decreased tumors at the genus level, and Lactospirillaceae that cross with larger tumors, but also shorter tumors. So genomic won't solve this problem. We have culture, these bugs. I will skip that, but we have a lot of candidates to work through because we have able to single isolate them and identify them. This is the last slide. The idea here is to get, these slides, classic heterogeneity in population exposed to drug, different outcome. And I like to propose that just because I like to create chaos a little bit, so that if you superimpose microbiome composition metabolism pathways, it complex the view of the disease and drug response, but it may allow you to design microbes that fit better the outcome. And that's precision medicine of the microbiome. I'll stop here. I'd like to thank Rad Garaby, who did all the microbiome genomic and the fundings. And sorry for going over. Thank you.
Great talk. Thank you very much. We have a couple of questions, and I'm sure more are coming in, and we have about 4 or 5 minutes to answer. Jeff Oletta asks, any effects of diet, which is also my question, on findings and any contribution from metabolites such as butyrate that protects against graft versus host disease?
No, absolutely. I mean, yes, diet is a big, like I said, one of my cartoon diet is a another modifier for good or bad. So if you push the microbiome, if you feed the microbiome with a diet that is not conducive to a good output of metabolite, which we have not quite identified. Yeah, short chain fatty acid is one classic example, but it goes beyond that. And we lack clarity into which kind of diet. We kind of know the diet that is, conducive to good health and prevent cancer. The question is, do they interface the same way with the microbiome? And we're not 100% sure how it works. But yes, I heard the stories and the data from Andy Anderson, where I think it's Jennifer Wargo is looking at short chain fatty acid producer with high fibers and could correlate high fibers intake with a better response to PD-1. So now you could start drilling this down. And example like that will come for sure with different type of diet. I'm not sure what's the other question.
Another question, how does antimicrobial proteins such as S100 family proteins regulated by microbial carcinogenic network?
How does antimicrobial protein, you mean the
Such as S100 family proteins.
Okay, regulate microbial. Yeah, we don't know. I mean, there is knockout of penicillin, for example, are the main producer of antimicrobial peptide, and you look at the microbiome, and it's not clear that they change the microbiome. So, you don't swing it in a big way. I'm not saying there's no impact. Maybe the antimicrobial peptide has a discrete effect in a gradient, very local to the tissue. So it doesn't swing into the entire environment. So you do fecal analysis, you don't see it. Maybe if you sample in a very discrete region, you will see the impact. And whether or not they disrupt microbiome network, carcinogenic network, I don't know. I can't tell you for sure. I mean, they will have to have a direct effect on some of these bugs. And these antimicrobial peptides have effect on gram negative, such as E. coli, and maybe taking them down. But you could maybe use this strategy to kill these bugs, enhance host antimicrobial effect, or even go with an artificial way to destroy these bugs that carry genotoxin, for example.
Okay, great, thank you. And with that, I think we're out of time for our session.
Thank you.
Hey, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Anne Kestrin Eisfeld. I'm an assistant professor here in the Division of Hematology. And today I have the distinct honor of introducing to you Dr. Elaine Mardis, who has been and who still is my mentor now since several years, and who's a role model not only for me, but for many of us. So I'm really glad she can be with us today. So Dr. Mardis is currently the co-executive director of the Steve and Cindy Rasmussen Institute of Genomic Medicine at Nationwide Children's, where she also holds the foundation endowed chair of genomic medicine. And she's also professor of pediatrics here at The Ohio State University at the College of Medicine. So Dr. Mardis initially started her training at the University of Oklahoma, followed by postgraduate work at Bio-Rads, and was then after that a member of the faculty of WashU from 1993 up until 2016, when she luckily joined our faculty here. Dr. Mardison, I think I don't need to give much introduction to that. Has authored more than 350 articles in peer-reviewed journals, has been listed since 2013 as one of the most highly cited researchers in the world by Thomson Reuters. She received countless awards, including the Morton Schwartz Award from the American Association of Clinical Chemistry. She has been, she is still the immediate past ACR president, and one of the greatest honors was also for her to be elected as a fellow of the ACR Academy and the National Academy of Medicine just last year. So with that, I'm very much looking forward to the talk that's upcoming. And so welcome, Dr. Mardis.
Well, thanks, AK, for the nice introduction. And it's a pleasure to have been invited to speak today at the PIOO Symposium. I'm going to talk today about the research that I have going on here in my lab at Nationwide Children's Hospital, looking at changes that occur in the immune tumor microenvironment in the setting of recurrent pediatric CNS cancers. So just to get things started, I wanted to give a little bit of background. You know, like many malignancies, the WHO provides periodic updates on classification, and this is no different for CNS tumors, which are typically classified by their pathologic features and cell type of origin. And I'm just listing here a few of the common categories that are utilized, predominantly based on pathology-based examination under the microscope and the use of a variety of immunohistochemistry stains and so on, as well as the conventional H&E. What we've really grown to understand over time is that there are additional nuances to these classifications, not the least of which include some of the resident cells that are in and around these tumors as they emerge in the central nervous system. One of the sort of conundrums that's been the recent subject of investigation is really the cancer immunity connection, if you will, where we can see that there are a variety of, from this diagram shown here, that there are a variety of ways that tumors can elicit the engagement of the immune system, essentially by producing very unique peptides, having these presented as antigens by dendritic cells, and essentially acting to prime the immune system for interaction with the cancer. Of course, the work brilliantly described by Bob Schreiber, who will be presenting later today, also shows us that there are ways that the immune interaction with the cancers can be suppressed over time. And this is one of the areas that we've taken up exploring using a data set that's been generated from the pediatric CNS patients here at our hospital. Part of the challenge in really understanding how this works is understanding the lymphatic system that's located within the CNS, a relatively new discovery just a few years ago, that really suggests that maybe the way we've been thinking about tolerance and the immune privileged environment of the brain should be revisited. I'm going to walk you through today is really sort of an early series of explorations that we've been taking in my lab, again, using this fundamental data set, some new technologies and bioinformatic approaches, and trying to get a cross-comparability to really understand what these changes are in high level of detail and how concordant or discordant these different ways of measuring the tumor in the microenvironment in longitudinal or progression series are compared to one another. So we often refer to this as multiplex characterization. This is really driving towards the hope that we can utilize this information to really start to think about immunotherapy in the context of pediatric cancer, not just in the context of adult cancer. And we think that, you know, the benefits that many adult cancer patients have and will continue to realize based on immunotherapeutic intervention should also be available to children as well. And I've listed a few here. Some of which I'll talk about just at the end that we're starting to really evaluate in the context of some new funding that we have. So as a run-up to this, the study that I'll tell you about today is really based on preliminary data that's been generated from a comprehensive protocol that we have, studying patients in the hospital using DNA and RNA profiling, and focused on all solid tissue malignancies, but with the preponderance of these patients being in the CNS setting. And the idea is to take this primary data set, evaluate it in a number of different ways, and start to understand what changes occur in the immune cell infiltrates during progression, which may indicate the different types of immunotherapy these patients may benefit from. So this is just a brief overview of our genomic profiling protocol. The eligibility is really predominantly in patients with either rare or relapse or treatment refractory cancers, where in several cases we've been able to not only study the relapse or treatment refractory disease, but also the primary presentation from that patient for these types of comparative analyses that I'll show you data for. When we're profiling these patients, we use what I call Exome Plus. This is high coverage, about 250-fold, looking not just at cancer-associated genes in the exome, but also copy number changes across the chromosomes. We also study RNA-seq with multiple analyses, including ones that pertain to the TME, and also have methylation arrays using a classification from the DKFZ for CNS cancers. Finally, we also have a fusion assay from Archer DX, which is a CAP-CLIA validated assay I won't talk about today, but we can either derive fusions from this focused assay or from the RNA-seq data. This is just a pie graph to break down the most recent proportions of different types of CNS tumors that we've studied over time. And of this relatively large set, which as I mentioned, comprises over 50% of nearly 200 cases that have been studied so far on this protocol, we have about 12 longitudinal cases that I mentioned a minute ago where we can actually get both the primary version of the disease as well as one or more recurrences for the purposes of study. The analysis pipeline that we've developed is shown here. This is an Amazon Web Services-based computational analysis that takes this data. On the top level, you can see tumor normal, whole exome sequencing, through our Churchill Rapid Aligner and into a variety of variant detection modes. On the bottom, the RNA sequencing data also is aligned by Churchill, evaluated with respect to the gene expression profiles, and then goes through a variety of different analyses, including fusion detection, which I mentioned, variant calling, and then on the bottom rightmost corner, a variety of different evaluations for the tumor microenvironment, including neoantigen prediction. So imputing the tumor immune microenvironment can occur through CyberSort, or more recently, CyberSort X, which was just described in 2019. I think most people are familiar with how this works, but it's essentially a pattern matching algorithm that evaluates the bulk tumor RNA expression and essentially assigns to known gene expression signatures for different types of immune cells. And so that's the action of CyberSort, and what comes out is a significance threshold-based proportionality for different immune cell types that are present, according to the matching that's done to this LM22 expression matrix. And of course, the change in the most recent version of CyberSort is that this matrix was trained not from microarray data, the original CyberSort, but now from RNA-seq-based data of flow-sorted immune cell types. So this is one mechanism for evaluating the tumor immune microenvironment that I'll show data for. The other approach is using NanoString's immunoprofiler assay. I think most people are familiar with NanoString, this sort of barcoded hybridization-based approach where the linear barcodes are then read out by a scanner and assigned back to specific groups according to the design on the probes. We typically want to include this type of evaluation because oftentimes we're studying formal and fixed paraffin embedded tissues and we don't have much high quality RNA to utilize. And in this case, of course, we have the immunoprofiler assay that's produced by NanoString, which encodes these barcoded probes to read out a variety of different immune cell functions, as illustrated by this, this graphic that shows you that there are 24 different immune cell types and populations that can be described. So again, if we're doing both NanoString and the CyberSort approach that I just described, how concordant or discordant or even complementary are those two approaches to one another? So let's take a look using these different tool sets about what we've learned from some longitudinal samples just to give an illustration. I won't show you examples from all 12 that I mentioned, but just a few highlights. Here's one example of a patient where we have two samples, one from 2015 and one from 2017. Using RNA expression and this principal components analysis plot, you can see that these two tumors are relatively close to one another in terms of their RNA expression profiling, although the pathology diagnosis was for one atypical mixed glioneuronal tumor, or anaplastic ganglioblioma, depending upon which pathologist read it out. And the 2015 was classified as a glioma. So our EPIC 850 methyl array did not classify strongly with any CNS tumor type. So this remains a bit of a mixed or indeterminate diagnosis using that type of profiling. And RNA analysis, we were actually able to identify a fusion that looked like a driver in both of the primary and recurrent samples. So this is a bit of an outlier tumor. But what do we learn when we look at the different aspects of its genomics? Well, first, the true genomic comparison is shown here on the left-hand side, this plot comparing the primary tumor on the x-axis, the recurrent tumor on the y-axis, and just different mutations that are occurring either in the primary or the recurrent tumor. What you can see quite readily is there are only a couple that are shared here, J2 and PM182. The other thing you can see is that on the y-axis, the recurrent tumor has an increased mutational burden. And then correspondingly, on the right-hand side of plots, what we've done is basically looked at the neoantigen profile of the primary recurrent tumor, where you can see that there are a significantly higher number of predicted neoantigens for the recurrent tumor compared to the primary, these red dots, based on being strong binders at 500 nanomolar or lower. So that's the neoantigen and mutation profile. What did we learn from the TME? Well, first, using immunohistochemistry and a stain for a variety of different immune cell markers you can see along the bottom, we're comparing here the immunohistochemistry of the primary, the lower panel of stains, to the recurrent, the upper panel of stains. And in each case, you can see an increased amount of staining in the recurrent cancer. Focused in particular on the CD163 on the far right. This is a marker for M2 macrophages, which we'll come back to in just a moment. When we use this estimate-based approach, an algorithm that also works from RNA sequencing data, we can also see that comparing the primary to the recurrent, there's a significant increase in the immune score, that second score, which is negative in the primary and quite positive in the recurrent cancer. And then to add on to this, the CyberSort analysis is shown at the bottom, with the primary tumor on the upper panel, the recurrent tumor on the lower panel, and this, dark yellow color corresponding to an increased amount of M2 macrophages here right in the center of the slide. You can also see some changes in other immune markers, but just overall an increase in the macrophage population in aggregate. So that's one example where we're comparing just primary immunohistochemistry stains to the CyberSort and estimate analyses, estimate being more of a bulk comparison. Let's drill down a little bit more on this very unique patient that's being shown here. This is a patient essentially with PMS2 germline and somatic alterations and an ultra-mutated glioblastoma. You can see over time the different re-presentation and representation of this patient's tumor, and this patient is now being treated on anti-PD-1 therapy. So again, let's look at the comparison between the immunohistochemistry stains on the left-hand side. These are all CD163 staining. We're going from the bottom to the top. The bottommost stain is the primary tumor, and that corresponds to the CyberSort analysis just to its right. And then the upper three stains are from different portions of that recurrent tumor that was taken by gross total resection just a few months after the primary. Correspondingly, there are different cellularities in these tumors. Those are written out to the right-hand side, but you can see that especially for the two particular recurrent sections, there's an increase again in the M2 macrophages, M1 and M0, and especially here in this portion of the tumor, a significant increase in macrophage infiltration. This tells us a couple of things. One is that not all infiltration is created equal, and that because of the beauty of the immunohistochemistry stains, we can actually get a good appreciation for the level of infiltration also into the tumor mass that's gone missing essentially in this bulk tumor analysis shown here. So we're missing out the spatial presentation of immune cells, which may be important as, to understand as well. Just to follow up with the rest of the analysis on this patient, I'm showing here now the nanostring predictions. Again, the bright pink dot is the primary tumor and the blue, green, and orange dots are from the different recurrent sections. They almost always group around one another. And in every case, with the exception of T helper cells that are shown here, fourth from the left, the primary tumor has a lower level of every type of cell type that's evaluated. You can see them written across the bottom here, hopefully, by the nanostrings. This is quite different in the comparison of primary to recurrent. And then if we look at the different checkpoints, we see a very similar story. So PD-1 at the upper left, PD-L1 on the upper right, CTLA-4, very different on the lower left, and ICOS is also shown on the lower right. So this also corresponds nicely to the fact that this patient was put on to PD-1 therapy, as I mentioned earlier. But let's just finish up now talking about this need for spatial resolution and the digital spatial profiling tools that are now becoming available in the marketplace. One of the areas where we've invested is in the nanostring genomics digital spatial profiler. You'll see this allows us to do detection of up to 80 different antibodies using a single FFPE slide and these barcoded adapters, much like is done for the nanostring immunoprofiler. This is a unique workflow that's shown on the right-hand side of the slide that involves basically staining slides with antibodies, imaging them in the genomics platform to identify regions of interest. Those regions of interest have their oligos cleaved from the antibodies. They're collected up, put into the nanostring assay, and then read out on the end counter, much like you would for a standard nanostring assay. So that's really how this works. We've just been able to process a few samples with the genomics so far. One of these on the bottom is this patient that I was just talking about a few minutes ago with the hypermutator phenotype. Two on the top are a medulloblastoma primary and a recurrent tumor in the same patient, CH42, that was determined to be a radiation-induced glioma. So let's take a look at that real quick. First of all, again, the comparison of the mutational profile is shown here. In this particular case, we've got the axes switched. So primary tumor is on the y-axis, the recurrent tumor is on the x-axis, and you can see that these tumors do not share any mutations whatsoever, which tells us they're very different in origin. The recurrent tumor has a significant increase in the number of mutations as in the previous case that I described. Here the colors are a little different and I apologize for that, but what you can see is comparing the 2012 medullobe to the 2018 glioma, again, just in a different color here now, M2 macrophages are significantly infiltrating in the glioma from 2018 in the recurrent setting, as well as a significant uptick in the M0 macrophages and monocytes. So a similar story here for infiltration in the immune system. Now just a quick look from the nanostring results. I'm jumping back to CH153 just to give you an illustration of what the different staining sections look like. And then these round circles are the selected regions of interest where we're wanting to evaluate further the content. And you can see that we're staining with red for CD45 rather for immune cell stain, and green for the tumor cells themselves. Now, if we just take a look at the this particular section and the results that we get from it on the readout, you can see the significant staining here of CD45 and pan cytokeratin, so high immune infiltrate and tumor cells. Here, a much more negative for both of these markers. And this is read out on this graph from the normalized counts off of the nanostring end counter, where you can see the significant difference here in CD163. So the M2 macrophage marker again predominates in this context of the sort of two different sections that we're looking at from the region of interest evaluation. So again, we're early days here, but I think this will be an interesting exercise, again, to correlate back to the CyberSort analyses that we're doing, the nanostring immune profiler, the immunohistochemistry, and now with this new version of immunohistochemistry to evaluate its concordance and what it adds in to our understanding of not only the tumor microenvironment, but its arrangement within the tumor mass. This is just, a quick readout comparing the primary from CH42 from these genomics profiles for the CD163 counts, primary on the left, a significant uptick on the recurrent tumor on the right-hand side. So the conclusions, just to wrap up from these longitudinal studies, is that we have a recurrent high-grade CNS cancers with multiple lines of evidence that macrophages and monocytes are in the TME, that they're recruited in from the periphery, and that they're minimally present, as you can tell, in the primary cancer tumor microenvironment. These likely provide an immune suppressive context, especially the M2 macrophages based on the checkpoint blockade. And the presence of neoantigen encoding alterations may present also an avenue to engage the immune system, often through engineering of different cell types in the immunotherapy realm. There are differences in pediatric immune systems that are age-based, and we need to be cognizant of those as we approach these therapies, but may invoke the need for some novel approaches above and beyond checkpoint blockade therapy. And so we're really pleased to have a recently funded U54 from the NCI to start exploring these new immunotherapy approaches for pediatric cancers, including oncolytic viruses and engineered natural killer cells. We're well underway on this coming out of the research shutdown, and hopefully next time I'll have some important new data to show you from those studies as well. So I'll just finish up by thanking the team at IGM, all of our clinical collaborators that contribute to the work that I've talked about here. I want to acknowledge my postdoc, Katie Miller, who's supported by the Mark Foundation for Cancer Research, and special thanks to our patients and families, and to all of you for your attention. Thanks, and I'm happy to take any questions.
Thank you so much, Dr. Martis, that was awesome. I am waiting, actually, they're coming, some questions already coming to the chat. I also have one, but otherwise I'll come later with those. So one question coming in here is whether you see a good correlation of different methods that were used to evaluate the TME.
It's a little too early to say. I think to your point, that's pretty important. We don't have the full spate of analyses quite finished yet, and we're obviously always getting, unfortunately, to some extent, additional longitudinal specimens coming in available for our study. So a patient with a very aggressive glioblastoma that we just studied last week, for example. So I would call this ongoing at this point in time. We really don't have enough numbers, I think, to start to make strong statistical comparisons, which would be the important thing to do. I will say that my general sense is that we're going to have a lot of synergy in terms of these different measures and what they tell us about the tumor microenvironment. And ultimately, what we would really like to be able to do is tie these into a variety of different monitoring regimens,
yeah.
For example, by liquid biopsy, so that we could not just study the recurrent tumor after the fact, but actually be able to predict patients that are starting to recur, for example, by looking at immune markers that are carried in exosomes, an active area of investigation in our lab right now, as well as maybe in cerebral spinal fluid, which is a little harder to come by, but not impossible. So it's early, but it's a lead up to things that we think are gonna make a difference in terms of medical care over time, which is really what the IGM is all about.
Yeah, I'm glad you pointed towards like this longitudinal monitoring, which would have been one of my questions. But I see one more question coming up here from Lisa, who wants, actually you addressed a little bit of it, who wants to know whether you were able to have tumor specimens of sufficient size to really choose regions that avoid tissues, issues of like sampling, to just have tumor initially and then more stroma when they are progressing. going in that
way? Yeah, great question, Lisa. Thank you for that. The answer is generally yes. You know, of course, it depends a lot on the point at which the tumor is detected, where it's located in the brain in terms of whether gross total resection is possible or not, which is obviously often sometimes a difficulty. What we have done successfully is to talk enough at tumor board with our neurosurgery colleagues for them to understand that especially these high-grade tumors, if they are all coming out in a gross total resection, the partitioning of different regions of the tumor into separate sort of flash frozen entities is critically important and allows us to really look at heterogeneity and ultimately in that last bit with the geomics to look at spatial heterogeneity. So I agree that that's critically important, and our notion of, you know, normally sort of mashing everything up and studying it together while convenient is kind of just giving us part of the story. And especially if we're gonna wanna understand in these novel immunotherapies that I talked about just at the last, how we're doing in terms of recruiting in, you know, T cells, for example, we've got to be able to look across multiple sections of the tumor. So the U54 is primarily preclinical, so mouse models, but I think it will give us the, you know-how now to really go after this in the human setting, which is, of course, the long-term goal.
Okay. I was just told more questions. I think I will pass them on to later because I was told to now that this was the last question. We have to break off and we'll start with the next presentation right at 3:20. So thank you again. And thank you for everybody for having so many great questions here.
Yes, thanks so much.
Good afternoon, everyone. It is both a great privilege and honor to introduce our next speaker for this session, Dr. David Carbone. So Dr. Carbone is a professor of internal medicine and director of the James Thoracic Oncology Center here at the OSU Medical Center. He is also co-director of the Translational Therapeutics Program and serves as the Barbara J. Bonner Chair in Lung Cancer Research. Dr. Carbone is also a renowned physician scientist who conducts both laboratory and clinical research focused on lung cancer. His lab has made several seminal contributions to understanding the molecular biology of lung cancers and developing novel approaches to improving personalized immunotherapy in lung cancer patients. Specifically, his lab focuses on proteomics and expression signature development, lung cancer genetics, tumor-associated immunosuppression mechanisms, as well as proteogenomic profiling of lung cancers. He is also renowned in research that has looked at continually funded by the NCI for several years, and he has authored over 250 peer-reviewed publications, including book chapters. These contributions have been recognized both nationally and internationally. Among his numerous awards, he is also named to the Castle Connolly list of Americans top doctors since 2014, again in 2020 this year. He has served on the board of scientific counselors and also the past president for the International Association for the Study of Lung Cancer. He is currently chair of the Lung Biology Subcommittee for the Eastern Cooperative Oncology Group. It is my great pleasure to introduce to you Dr. David Carbone. Thank you.
Hello, my name is David Carbone. I'm a medical oncologist here at Ohio State, and I've been asked to present on the impact of immunotherapy on patients with lung cancer. My disclosures are here. Lung cancer is the leading cause of cancer mortality in the United States and worldwide in both men and women. It's a fact not often recognized. But what was it like when I started in lung cancer 30 years ago? Patients were almost always diagnosed with advanced disease. Very few chemotherapy drugs were available. There were no good antiemetic regimens to improve side effects. Most patients got no treatment at all, believe it or not, other than morphine and possibly palliative radiation. And survival was terrible. It was unclear at that point whether therapy improved survival at all. And this, they actually did randomized trials of doing nothing versus doing chemotherapy. It's published in 1995, not all that long ago, that showed that there was a slight improvement in survival with chemotherapy compared to doing nothing. But the median survival in this study was still about 6 months from diagnosis to death. Then we developed some chemotherapies we were very proud of and thought that they for sure would really make an impact on outcomes in metastatic lung cancer. This was a 1,200 patient study that compared four of the modern regimens at the time. And as you can see, they were all identical and resulted in about an 8-month median survival, with understanding that these are all excellent performance status patients treated by the best doctors at major academic centers. No difference between these regimens, 8 months median survival, and anecdotal survival at 3 years. And this was published in 2002. But over the last decade or so, lung cancer deaths have really tended dramatically down in both sexes. And it wasn't just prevention and smoking cessation that caused those changes. This shows the trends in lung cancer 5-year survival in the United States after the diagnosis, where now more than for decades, the 5-year survival hung around 10%. But in the last reporting period where 5-year data is available, it's now almost doubled at over 20% 5-year survival. And it's not, as I said, this is not only due to better prevention, but increased survival after diagnosis. And we've also made improvements in quality of life. And in just in this year, and the last few years, there have been more FDA approvals for lung cancer than in the previous 30. And in 2020 alone, there are multiple new drugs, multiple new first-line regimens received approval. And now we're looking at 5-year survival in studies as a landmark. And as you recall, we were talking about 6-month survivals years ago. These new therapies were consequence of striking results from genetically targeted therapies and immunotherapies. But for someone with a PhD in genetics, it's very satisfying that all of these results came as a consequence of advances in basic science studies. But there's still a lot of unmet needs. This is an example of the effectiveness of a science-based targeted strategy against genetic abnormalities. This is a patient I saw years ago with an ALK fusion positive lung cancer who was diagnosed when she was probably within weeks of death as having this fusion kinase. We started her on kinase inhibiting therapy, and when I saw her a few months later in clinic, her CT scan was completely normal and she had a normal quality of life. So these effects are dramatic when you understand the science and target it appropriately. So with genetically targeted therapies, we've become used to virtually every patient responding to the targeted therapy. But most tumors don't have driver mutations. And so why, what are you going to do about that? Why immunotherapy and why lung cancer? This is a slide that I borrowed from and modified from Matt Meyerson, where he said, every cancer genome is uniquely altered from its host, normal genome, and quotes Leo Tolstoy saying, happy families are all alike. Every unhappy family is unhappy in its own way. So the normal genomes are mostly alike, and every cancer genome is abnormal in its own way and has a unique set of genome alterations from its normal host. And lung cancer is one of the types of cancer that has one of the highest average number of somatic mutations, as shown here. So how do you treat a cancer when every tumor is different? When you have a driver mutant tumors, the you have a commonality between tumors that you target with a specific drug. But how do you treat a cancer when every cancer is different and you can't find a target? Well, these hundreds of genetic alterations make tumor cells different from normal cells. They result in novel proteins only present in the cancer, and the immune system is exquisitely capable of recognizing foreign novel proteins and killing cells expressing them. Thus, lung cancer should theoretically be an excellent target for immunotherapy. However, it's very true that in order for a tumor to become clinically apparent, it must have evaded the immune system. And many current immunotherapies focus on helping the immune system recognize the tumor that it had previously ignored. So in this audience, it's a little intimidating with all the amazing basic sciences at this scientists at this symposium to mention this, but it is true that these somatic alterations are detected by a process of processing and assembly into class 1 MHC, transport into the Golgi and then to the cell surface where short peptides are presented to T cells on MHC. And it is true that if there are defects in this pathway, these peptides can't get presented. And years ago, we reported that we found a homozygous TAP1 loss mutation in a lung cancer that causes complete loss of MHC and loss of ability of tumors to be killed by CTL. So if you put the normal TAP1 back into these cells, they increase MHC expression and they become killable by specific T cells. But this is really rare, and other tumors must escape recognition by other mechanisms. So several years ago, this paper was published by Dr. Hanjo, called Induced Expression of PD-1, a novel member of the immunoglobulin gene superfamily. And so what they did is they just looked at common biochemical pathways involved in two different ways of killing cells. And they took 20,000 clones in the library, and they were overlapping, and four clones hybridized even under stringent conditions, and they called this PD-1. And this resulted, after many additional experiments, in the pathway most commonly targeted in lung cancer, the PD-1 pathway. And that and the anti-CTLA-4 pathway are the most common effect clinically utilized immunotherapy targets today. So what is the effect on outcomes in patients? This is one of the very first trials of pembrolizumab in lung cancer, shown for high PD-L1 and low PD-L1 patients, now with 5-year survival, treated as the first therapy after the diagnosis of lung cancer. And you can see that with a high PD-L1 treated in first line, you have almost 50% 5-year survival. And now this, remember the figure I showed you earlier, what the survival was historically with chemotherapy, where comparing the 40-month time point in these two curves, there's a huge differential in people who are alive at 40 months who would be dead at 40 months with chemotherapy alone. And even with low PD-L1 patients, there's still many times more people alive at 5 years than they would be with chemotherapy. And even in studies of pre-treated patients where they've had chemotherapy before and then get to single agent immunotherapy, we're now seeing very clear 5-year survivals that are many times that seen with chemotherapy. But again, the high PD-L1 patients have a better survival than the lower PD-L1. But even those with undetectable PD-L1 still have 4 times the 5-year survival of patients treated with single agent chemotherapy. So then in practice, we've started adding chemotherapy to pembrolizumab, to immunotherapy, and this does seem to improve outcomes, where you now see clear separation of survival curves with even in the zero PD-L1 patients, but clearly the efficacy is still better in the high PD-L1 patients. Now, this is not really true in the Keynote 407, which looked in squamous lung cancer, where the PD-L1 zero subset really had no statistically significant improvement in survival over chemotherapy. Just emphasizing that we've come a long way, but that we still have a ways to go. So recently this regimen was approved, and this is a combination of two immunotherapy agents in lung cancer. And just strikingly, in this study, there's a very long tail of this curve, which means if you're alive and at 2 years, you're very likely to be effectively cured by this regimen. And this is specifically showing the data from the patients with zero PD-L1 expression, showing that this regimen seems to be particularly active in the patients without PD-L1. And if you look at the durability of these responses in the zero PD-L1 population, those in response at 1 year tended to stay in response. But there's really a complete lack of head-to-head trials comparing these different first-line combinations. And as most of them, all of them were approved by comparison with chemo alone, which no longer is the standard of care. So when should you use IO monotherapy versus IO chemo versus IO therapies? There's really no reported trials, but there's one ongoing trial that is called INSIGNA, which directly compares IO monotherapy to IO chemotherapy and looks at other questions as well, adding chemotherapy to the pembro or switching to chemotherapy from pembro. And I think this will be an informative trial to help us select which one's better for which patient. But what about patients who don't benefit at all? You know, we've made a lot of progress, but there's still 70% of the patients dead at 3 years. So there's a lot of room for improvement. So what do we do for those who don't respond or benefit from current first line regimens or after progression on first line immunotherapy? There are many combination trials underway, including platform trials combining standard therapies with phase two agents in first or second line. There are many novel targets being addressed. There's an increased focus on the tumor microenvironment with hypoxia, metabolic modulation, targeting immune cells in the microenvironment. But still, the fact is that there's a near complete lack of decent biomarkers to allow us to intelligently choose which of these promising phase two agents to use. So in contrast to targeted therapies, we really are regressing to one size fits all, treating everybody with the same thing and not understanding how to select patients. This is just another example of a patient of mine who was started on therapy, presented with metastatic KRAS P53 mutant PD-L1 40% adenocarcinoma back in 2014. And he was put on a clinical trial with single agent nivolumab and had a nice response for a year. But then in 2017, he progressed with multiple liver metastases and was put on another clinical trial with a dual combination, keeping the nivolumab but adding ipilimumab. And he had an even better response in his lung and complete response of the lesion in his liver, and he's now off therapy since June of 2018, more than 2 years, with no evidence of progression. And we have no idea why he had such a great response to this combination, and you know, might have been even better off if we had known this ahead of time to start him on it initially. Other approaches at post-progression, this is just an example of a phase two that we were part of, combining nivolumab and sitravatinib in patients who've progressed on immunotherapy. So these are people progressing on pembrolizumab or nivolumab who then just get this oral sitravatinib added to their regimen, and they have a significant and durable response. But again, we have no idea how we identify the patients that really seem to be sensitive to this combination of VEGF and PD-1 pathway inhibitors. Other approaches are being tried. And this is an example of a study recently reported combining anti-TIGIT with an anti-PD-L1, showing a significant improvement in response rate and progression-free survival. But again, we have no clue how to identify the patients that need the TIGIT and those that don't. One way to try to discover these biomarkers is using neoadjuvant trials. Why would you use neoadjuvant? Well, there's some very promising results coming out. Actually, a trial recently had a press release showing that neoadjuvant chemoimmunotherapy had a very significant improvement in pathologic complete response at the time of surgery, where there was no tumor left when they went to go take it out. Adjuvant immunotherapy trials are completed and pending a readout. And there's a lot of theoretical advantages to neoadjuvant therapy, overcoming immune suppression while tumor and nodes are intact, radiographic and pathologic assessment of IO effect to guide adjuvant therapy after surgery. But I think in terms of biomarker discovery, it also allows unprecedented access to biomarkers. This is a national trial that I led with Valerie Ruch at Memorial called LCMC3. And this is where we gave two cycles of atezolizumab before surgery and then standard of care adjuvant therapy and then a year of atezolizumab afterwards. The intent of this study was not registrational, but in fact, all of the biospecimens we collected, and we were doing every correlative study we can think of in order to try to determine which patients respond and which don't. We're going to be presenting the clinical analysis at the World Conference on Lung Cancer in a few months, but we have intensive bioanalysis ongoing. Including this was presented at meetings and preliminary data showing that we also have a significant, a major pathologic response and pathologic complete responses in this study and correlations of various immunophenotypes in the peripheral blood with these responses. And we will report on the full data set sometime next year. So what's next? Just examples of ongoing James include notch modulation studies where we've shown improved recognition of neoantigens and anti-tumor. Yiping Yang and Dwight Owen are looking at the paracrine effects of tumor cells through sonic hedgehog signaling on tumor-associated macrophages and T-cell exhaustion, and have significant preliminary data in support of this project. Also studies targeting TGF-beta in the microenvironment led by Zihai Li. Studies targeting tumor hypoxia and immune suppression with very specific targeted agents led by Nick Denko and Terry Williams. Looking at specific mutational mechanisms of metabolic alterations and targeting those, led by Michael Koenig and Joseph Amon and myself, targeting and other microenvironmental mechanisms of immune suppression, such as adenosine signaling with the A2B receptor inhibitor, where we're now doing the human phase one of this trial. And in conclusion, I think immunotherapy is a mainstay of lung cancer therapy, with major improvements in 5-year survival, even potentials for cure. Recent progress comes largely from science with molecular characterization of tumors and application of this information to drug development and patient selection. And we are making progress, but a lot of work remains to be done, and we need new targets and better biomarkers to match the IO approach to the specific tumor and patient. Thank you.
Great talk, Dr. Cabon, and lots of important questions that are still left unanswered, and with opportunities actually to answer those questions. The floor is open for questions now. So one question from Professor Feng Ming is, when would you use RT and IO combination? He says, there are quite a few small randomized studies of showing the significant benefit of SBRT in oligometastatic disease. When would you refer your patients to SBRT?
We do it all the time. If there's a oligoprogressive disease on immunotherapy, we often use SBRT and continue the immunotherapy. And there have been clinical trials combining the two in a planned way. And I have another patient that had brain, bone, and lung primary disease, all three sites treated with SBRT. And we gave him concurrent immunotherapy, and he's now alive and progression-free 4 years later. And this was unheard of, especially with bone metastatic disease. So I really think there is a synergy, and we use it very frequently.
I don't see, okay, so there's a question from Dr. Lee. He says, so neoantigen IO study is a fantastic research tool, he mentioned. So what is the clinical utility for IO neoantigen therapy for early stage lung cancer? Are we moving away from surgery?
Question. Well, I think that's the extreme perspective, but I'd be a little reluctant now to avoid surgery. But we're looking at the clinical outcomes of these patients now, and with certain combinations in the neoadjuvant setting, we're having a 60% pathologic complete response rate before surgery. So I guess you could imagine in certain cases avoiding the surgery, but I think it's premature till we have the studies done right now. And I'm very happy when the tumor's in the pan and there's no viable tumor in it.
So one from Dylan Gall is, great talk. How about small cell lung cancer therapy progression? He says, is there any immunotherapy working in this subset?
I'm sorry, what was the question?
What about small cell lung cancer?
Oh, small cell. Yeah, we're right now adding immunotherapy to small cell as standard practice for extensive stage and results in improved survivals, though not dramatic, and long-term survival is still uncommon. But we're studying it in limited stage along with radiation. But again, some patients benefit, but not everybody, and we need new therapies.
And another one from Jin Wang. Did the patient, the KRAS P53 mutant, develop antigen-specific T-cell responses against the cancer cells?
We did not study his T-cell responses, but that would be a presumption because he had such a beautiful response, he must have. But we don't know which antigens he responded to.
Okay. And I think one last question is, what do you think of circulating biomarkers?
Well, we're studying them intensively in this neoadjuvant study. We've done a serial 10-color 14-tube flow on circulating PBMCs. But also uniquely in a neoadjuvant study, we had access to lymph nodes pre and post immunotherapies. So we're studying lymph node profiling pre and post, and we're studying T cell repertoire and cytokine expression in the plasma. And so it really would be nice if we had some either tumor-based or circulation-based biomarkers to help predict who benefits and who doesn't to this therapy.
Excellent. And our time is up, so I will hand over to the next session.
Thank you.
Great talk.
Hi, my name is Jerry Liu, and it's my great honor to introduce my next speaker, Eugene Otz. So Gene is the chair of the Department of Microbial Infection in MIT, and he is the Samuel Sasslaw Professor of Infectious Diseases here at OSU. So he's also currently serving as the editor-in-chief for the Journal of Immunology. So Gene obtained his PhD degree from Columbia University and did his postdoctoral training with Fred Ott at Columbia University and then at Harvard later, where he studied the regulation of gene receptor regulation rearrangement in developing lymphocytes. So after his postdoc, he started his lab at Vanderbilt University School of Medicine in 1994. And later he moved his lab to Washington University in St. Louis in 2009 and was recently recruited to OSU in 2019. So Gene has received many awards and have published many articles in journals such as Cell Immunity and the Journal of Immunology. So his lab has made many major discoveries in immunological research, including his studies of epigenomes and gene regulatory networks in innate lymphoid cells and lymphomas. His lab also studied how cis regulatory elements and epigenomes and the 3D genome structure regulating the antigen receptor rearrangement in lymphocytes as well. So more recently, his lab also is a part of the OSU Center to Stop COVID to investigate the immune response to SARS-CoV-2. So with that, he's going to talk about chromatin-based regulation of gene expression program in lymphoid cells. So here's our speaker, Gene.
Thanks so much, Jerry. I am going to try to share my screen, see how this goes. Is that working? Yeah, okay, good. All right, and we'll move to the socially distanced version of my current lab in the COVID era. And I just want to thank Zihai and the Pelotonia Institute for the opportunity to present in this very stellar lineup, as well as for our ongoing collaborations, both scientifically and in faculty recruitment. And with that, I'll just get right into it with one of my favorite, I think, analogies, yes. So like most complex machines, the plans for our bodies rely on an intricate circuitry, and most of that's devoted to the control of gene expression. And the switching on or off of these circuits begins at the earliest stage in development in pluripotent cells, where a small node of circuits becomes activated by factors like NANOG, but the majority, shown in yellow, remain poised. Now, as embryonic development proceeds, many of these poised circuits are shut off, as are the pluripotency circuits. However, each cell type in turn activates new circuitry regulated by so-called master transcription factors, and it cements their identities, in this case, as a liver cell. So what I'm going to tell you today is a few short stories describing some of the regulatory circuits that guide the development, function, and oncogenesis in lymphoid cells, and how we can identify major factors that orchestrate these processes with the eventual hopes of engineering these lymphoid subsets as more effective cellular therapeutics. So like all electronic circuitry, those controlling gene expression are composed of switches, modulators. The on-off switches for most genes are usually distal enhancers, which serve as conduits for transcription factors. And these turn alter accessibility of chromatin and the epigenetic landscape, where they print and erase histone modifications. And one of the key events is when the distal enhancer forms a physical contact with the promoter, flipping the gene switch on. Now, these changes in chromatin can be used to identify regulatory elements on a genome-wide basis. For example, accessible elements like enhancers can be identified by DNase or now ATAC-seq. But the relative activities of the elements themselves are best measured by ChIP-seq for specific histone modifications. And our lab really likes the modification called H3K27 acetylation, these little red clouds that are excellent readouts for enhancer activity. Now, genome-wide chromatin profiling has been applied to a wide range of different cell types, mostly by the ENCODE consortium. and they've mapped almost all the regulatory elements in the in mammalian genomes. And one of their major findings that I really love is that around 90% of disease-associated SNPs map to regulatory elements rather than the coding genome. So alterations in gene expression are probably the most important contributors to human disease. So here's just a simple example from one of our earliest forays into this field. And we wanted to identify circuits that were deregulated in a type of B-cell cancer you've all heard of, follicular lymphoma. When we compare the regulome with their normal counterparts from germinal centers and human tonsils, these cells called centrocytes. So here's one such aberrant circuit controlling the chemokine receptor CXCR4, which is of course important for compartmentalizing germinal center reactions. DNA-seq of cancer cells from these primary tumor biopsies provided really high resolution localization for two enhancer elements. But if you compare that with the K27 acetylation data, you can see that DNA-seq is not the best metric for relative enhancer activities. These enhancers are much more acetylated and active in follicular lymphoma compared with their normal counterparts, the centrocytes. And this correlates beautifully with augmented gene expression by RNA-seq. So these studies were performed about 6 years ago and required millions of cells per assay, but we and others have spent a considerable amount of time microscaling these chip assays so we could do them on around 25,000 cells. And it's similar to what we now routinely use for ATAC-seq when we're looking at accessibility. So this allowed us to probe the regulatory circuits of even scarce cell populations in the mouse and human immune systems and spawned a number of very productive collaborations, including one with Marco Colonna's lab while I was at WashU, but continues to be very productive today. And we first focused on the newest member of our immune repertoire, a scarce population of primarily tissue resident cells called innate lymphoid cells. And until recently, it was believed that the only crossover between the innate and the adaptive systems was the natural killer cell, which develops from lymphoid precursors, but like innate cells, they respond rapidly and lack specific antigen receptors. Over the past 5 years, however, it's become clear that the innate system is composed of direct functional counterparts to these CD4 T helper subsets, and these are the innate lymphoid cells. Again, they derive from lymphoid precursors, lack antigen receptors, and probably, we're beginning to believe, act as stopgaps until the slower, more specific T helper responses can be engaged. Now, in fact, because they respond to the same extracellular cues and express very similar cytokine cocktails, the T helper and ILCs have been lumped together into terms like type 1 cells for NK, ILC1, and TH1 cells. These express interferon gamma and are very effective at clearing intracellular pathogens. I'm not going to talk about type 2 cells, but the type 3 cells, the ILC3s and TH17s, express a cocktail of IL-17 and 22 and are great at clearing extracellular bacteria and fungi. But since the T helper and ILCs relied on similar master transcription factors, we wanted to look more deeply into the regulatory programs to understand how they could be react differently kinetically and what other functional aspects might differ between the cells. And this was the work of two very talented postdocs, Olivia Cues and Patrick Collins. Patrick is now a research assistant professor at OSU. And what they did was profile about 50,000 cells of each type from pooled human tonsils. And here's just one example of the insights you can get when you integrate epigenome with transcriptome data. This is the very, very well characterized locus for interferon gamma, which is highly expressed in type 1, but not type 3 cells. And what you can see is that there are two enhancers, however, that are active in all of these cell types. And this suggests that they're necessary for interferon gamma expression, but probably not sufficient. But they may also provide some degree of functional plasticity to these type 3 cells, the ILC3s. And we know that ILC3s under very specific cytokine conditions can be induced to express interferon. And this is something I'll get back to in a bit. Now, another enhancer, only 4 kb from the promoter, is active just like you'd expect it to be in only type 1 cells. And then more distal enhancers here, shown here, are preferentially active in the Th1 versus the ILC cells. And we now know that this reflects their responsiveness to factors downstream of TCR signaling. Of course, we can also look for motifs that are enriched in enhancers that are differentially active in these various populations to try to understand the major factors that orchestrate the development or function of each subset. And I'm just going to quickly go through the type 1 cells are enriched, as we expect, for T-box motif in their enhancers, which bind to their master factor, TBET. Type 3 cells, the enhancers enrich for ROR gamma T motifs. Maybe more interestingly, the T helper cells are enriched for, their enhancers are enriched for factors like AP1 or BATF that are downstream of the TCR. And ILCs are enriched for ETS and RUNX motifs in their enhancers. And it's subsequently been shown that members of both of these families do contribute substantially to ILC development. Now, more recently, we characterized regulatory programs for human NK subsets. This is the prototypical ILC1 population and the cells that provide frontline protection from viral infections and cancers. Now, in humans, the development and functional relationships between NK cells has remained a source of confusion. In blood, there are two NK subsets called CD56 bright, and these share important characteristics with helper type precursor cells, especially interferon gamma expression and homeostatic proliferation, and then the CD56 dim, which are the classical cytotoxic NK cells shown in the video on the right. Now, in terms of significance, a major clinical goal is here and at children's especially is to harness NK cells and their functions as tumor therapeutics. And this is especially important since recent studies indicate that some NK responses are characterized just like adaptive responses by expansion and memory of the cells. Now, in most cases, bulk NK cells are expanded thousands of fold and transferred back into patients. And this seems to be effective in treating at least some cases of AML and lymphoma, but there are substantial challenges that remain in treating solid tumors, especially with regard to immune evasion. So we'd really like to identify the gene expression modules in NK cells that are responsible for their important functions as cellular therapeutics, like homing, cytokine expression, and cytotoxicity, among others. So I won't go through the specific data, but Patrick Collins again used integrative omics profiling of human blood NK populations to define this factor-based regulatory scheme for maintaining the transcriptional identities of CD56 bright helper cells versus the dim effector populations. And in brief, the bright cells are positively coordinated by two transcription factors, TCF7, LEF1, related HMG factors, and these seem to target MYC and IL-7 receptor and likely control their homeostatic proliferation. Now, this bright program is inhibited in dim cells by two repressors called PRDM1 and ZEB2. But besides the repressors, the dim regulome seems to be under control of another factor called CMAP, which we think coordinates expression of major effector genes such as perforin and granzymes. Now, this counterbalance of positive and negative regulatories for NK phenotypes is indeed highly conserved from primates down to mice, and it bears striking resemblance to strategies that compartmentalize self-renewal, localization, and effector function in other lymphoid lineage, and shown here for mouse CD8 and NK cells, but also for CD4 T helper cells. So what we're hoping is that this is at least a blueprint, a start at defining some of the transcriptional modules that can be leveraged to enhance phenotypes for cell-based therapies. And in fact, I'll mention that TCF1 or 7 is the gene, is also expressed in a subset of CXCR5 positive CD8 T cells that proliferate in response to anti-PD-1 treatments for chronic infection and cancer. Now, our ability to assay for K27 acetylation in rare cells, rather than simply looking at these ATAC peaks, led us to look at another category of regulatory elements called superenhancers. And these, in essence, are just densely packed arrays of conventional enhancers. And these superenhancers are highly enriched for binding of lineage-specifying transcription factors. So it follows that many are associated with genes that are critical for the identity and functions of a given cell type, and they differ from cell type to cell type. So they can serve as discovery tools for tagging new identity genes and their key regulatory regions. And I'll show you briefly two examples of that in our studies of ILCs. For NK subsets, superenhancer analysis identified a collection of G protein coupled receptors, which may help NK cells respond to metabolites or other cues in the microenvironment. And as shown here, many of them encompass disease associated SNPs. For example, this locus, which encompasses GPR18 and 183, is spanned by a superenhancer that's active in the CD56 bright subset, as well as the ILCs, but not in the CD56 dim effectors. And this EBI2 gene, 183, is a receptor for oxysterols and has been shown to play a role in lymphocyte trafficking and inflammatory cytokine expression. So to test whether these bright subset of NK cells were responsive to the ligands for EBI2, we cultured them with an activating cytokine mixture, IL-12 and 18, either with or without ligands for EBI2, in this case, dihydroxycholesterol. And as you can see, we got a significant reduction in interferon expression when we cultured them with this GPR agonist. Now, another distinct example is an ILC3 specific superenhancer that spans a gene called CD300LF and its surrounding genes. CD300LF encodes for a glycoprotein that's thought to be an inhibitory receptor. And we see, even by flow, that it's predominantly expressed in ILC3s, providing a nice new marker to distinguish these cells in humans. Except there's a small population of ILC1s, which become quite interesting to us, or became quite interesting to us with regard to functional plasticity I mentioned earlier. And I'm not going to go into the separation scheme because of time, but in collaboration with Marina Cella and Marco's lab, we could separate the populations further into A and B subsets of ILC1 and ILC3. And when we looked at the transcriptomes, you could see these four populations clearly lie along a developmental track with intermediate levels of key transcription factors distinguishing ILC3 from ILC1. So along this track, ILC3s convert to ILC1s by losing RORC, as you would expect, by gaining TBET. But we also became interested in another transcription factor called ALOS, or IKZF3, which is a known repressor involved in many aspects of lymphoid cell function. And this is clear even at the protein level in this flow analysis. So this became a nice example of how these findings could guide cell engineering. We introduced TBET and ALOS into an ILC3 cell model called MNK3. And although we found, not surprisingly, that TBET was sufficient to turn on the ILC1 cytokine interferon gamma, its co-expression with ALOS was required to suppress what, let's just call it ILC3-ness, in this case, looking at the expression of the signature cytokine IL-22. So in the last couple minutes, I just want to switch gears a bit and emphasize really the dire need for all of us in the field to begin functionally testing at least some of the predicted regulatory circuits we're revealing by chromatin profiling. And this is, again, is the multigenic type 1, type 3 cytokine locus. You can see, like many lymphoid genes, the regulatory landscape, each of these peaks is an enhancer. The regulatory landscape's incredibly complex. And we think that reflects the need to activate or decommission expression of immune response genes in either distinct cell types or in response to a wide range of cues. So as we saw with interferon gamma, there might be enhancers dedicated for these different modes of regulation, and targeting each of these enhancers one at a time is of course way too complex for labs, at least of my size. As an example of the approaches that the field is taking, we began to look for cell type specific enhancers that control expression of IL-22 using high throughput screening systems. And what I've shown here is that we can employ fusions of nuclease defective Cas9 fused directly to a potent repressor called CRAB. And we can do this in conjunction with libraries of tiled guide RNAs that span the entire regulatory space of interest. We can then sort cells that have significantly reduced expression of IL-22 and look for enrichment or depletion of the guides targeting each of these regulatory elements. And so Ankita Saini did this. She's a proud Pelotonia postdoctoral fellow. And she did this again in the MINK3 cell model. What she clearly identified were two enhancers that are important for IL-22 expression upon induction with physiologic agonists, in this case, IL-23 and IL-1 beta. What I'm showing you is that the same pattern of guide depletion in IL-22 high cells, shown here, and enrichment in the IL-22 negative population, we got that same pattern when we used our control guides that directly targeted the IL-22 promoter. So these are clearly important for IL-22 expression. She's gone on to delete each of these elements in mice and finds that the more distal enhancer, E1, specifically cripples IL-22 expression in T helper cells, with E2 having no specific significant impact. And instead, we were very excited to find that the proximal enhancer, E2, specifically affects IL-22 expression in ILC3s with no significant reduction in the E1 deleted cells. So we now expect these to be important mouse models for dissecting cell type specific roles of IL-22 during pathogen clearance and oncogenesis, especially given that IL-22 is shown to promote cancer growth, especially colon cancer. But the cellular sources of this cytokine in the process have been really difficult to pin down. And from a more technical viewpoint, the enhancers themselves may provide a new tool for one of the holy grails in the field, deleting genes specifically in ILC3 using potentially E2 as a Cre driver. So with that, I'll close. I hope you've gathered how integrative omics approaches can provide new insights, not only into the cysts, but also the trans factors that govern key biological processes. These insights generate testable hypotheses, and ultimately we hope to leverage these to engineer cells into better therapeutics for our battle against cancer. And with that, I thank most of the people who've done the work I've described, but many thanks to the rest of my lab who are looking at gene regulation, and my collaborators around the world, our funding sources, including OSU and Pelotonia. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Gene. So CI has a question. So he wanna know whether or not how the innate lymphocytes are programmed in the tumor microenvironment, and also do they undergo exhaustion?
Say that again. Sorry, a helicopter conveniently decided to fly over right now.
He was talking about the innate lymphocytes and like how are they programmed in the tumor microenvironment, and also whether or not they undergo exhaustion.
That is an outstanding question, and one we really like to answer. I think there is some evidence that NK cells may undergo some sort of exhaustion, but it's something that we'd really like to we'd really like to look into. Thanks, Ihai.
So I have a question. So is there an exhaustion module for tumor infiltrating NK cells and CD8 T cells that contributing to the inefficiency of them killing the tumor cells?
Yeah, a lot of them look a lot like TGF, downstream TGF factors, but also as John Wary and others have now pointed out, there may be a transcription factor. They call it the master transcription factor of exhaustion. I'm not sure a lot of people buy into that, but at least associated with exhaustion, and that's a factor called TOX1 that is clearly impacting the functionality, not just of CD8 cells, but of probably a number of other cell types.
Right, so that's one more question. So is Cassian Lee's question, did you look into NK cell memory?
Did I look into, and no, we have not specifically sorted out those subsets and looked more deeply into that. That's something I think that Patrick might be doing, Patrick Collins might be doing with his new collaborators, yes.
Oh, that's one more question. So have you tested how exhausted CD8 T cells or NK cells alter their super enhancer activities?
No, we haven't, because again, we haven't specifically looked at exhausted. It's something, if people are out there that we, you know, collaborating with, I know that Hazem is looking at exhaustion, CD8 T cell exhaustion from the methylated epigenome. We'd be very happy to look at it, to look for super enhancers as well. Yeah.
All right. I think that's all the questions.
Thank you, Gene. Thank you.
All right. So my name is Brian Riesenberg. I am a postdoc in Dr. Zihai Lee's lab, and it is my great privilege to introduce the final speaker for today, Dr. Cassian Yi. Dr. Yi is an MD and a professor of melanoma, medical oncology, and immunology at the Division of Cancer Medicine, and is the director of the Solid Tumor Therapy Center for Cancer Immunology Research at the University of Texas MD Anderson Cancer Center. Dr. Yi's lab has been engaged in the study of tumor immunology and adoptive cellular therapy over the last 20 years, and they have focused their research towards an understanding of human T cell biology, anti-tumor immunity, and the development of translational strategies, which they have applied to several first-in-man studies of adoptive cellular therapy. Dr. Yi's lab pioneered endogenous T cell therapy using peripheral blood as the source of T cells for ACT, and the use of IL-21 for generating long-lasting central memory type T cells. Established several protocols using the combination of adoptive cellular therapy and immune modulation, specifically with immune checkpoint inhibitors, co-stimulatory agonists, oncolytic virotherapy, and demonstrated that durable clinical responses can be achieved in patients with refractory solid tumor malignancies without serious adverse toxicities. A major focus of Dr. Yi's lab is to investigate combination strategies of checkpoint blockade and adoptive T cell therapy for the treatment of cancers such as uveal melanoma and pancreatic cancer. A second major focus has been the development of antigen discovery pipeline to identify and fully validate immunogenic targets for cell therapy. And with that, Dr. Yi, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much for the introduction. I know many of you are looking forward to Bob giving his talk, so I apologize. I'm not in the same intellectual stratosphere as Bob, and he's probably better looking. Sorry he wasn't here to hear that. These are my disclosures, and I came with the title, which I think now is a mistake.
Sorry to interrupt. Oh. I think you need to share your screen first.
Oh my God, sorry. I'm just seeing all the good stuff here. Hang on. I think I started the presentation without the share, so that got me. Here we go. Can you see that?
Perfect.
Okay, let me put it on the main screen here. There we go. These are my disclosures. So I was asked to give a title, and just off the top of my head, I think this might have been a mistake because nobody expected 2020 to be like this in any way, although certainly has been a dangerous year. And in Texas, not that we don't have enough natural and unnatural disasters, but I think that when I moved here from the West Coast to Texas, it seems like I was stocking up on the wrong items for the next surge. So with that, I think we all know that the immune system needs some sort of danger or in order to be effective. And you've heard talks already from Elaine and Tony and others how one of these methods might be to increase the effective population in some way, but also to find and acquire targets to more broadly apply immune-based therapies. And then, of course, tumor immune evasion, something which Miriam discussed and many others as well. And certainly these are not the entire scope of all the tenets that are required to make the immune system more effective. But what I'll try to do is fold in two sets of unpublished data recently described in our lab. But as the background for that, RWO house is an adoptive cell therapy. And as you heard, an endogenous T cell therapy. These are really possibly arbitrarily three different modalities for T-cell based therapies, TIL therapy, which you all know is derived from tumor infiltrating lymphocytes, first developed in Steve Rosenberg's lab, requiring ex vivo expansion with high-dose IL-2 and then administration to patient with lymphodepletion conditioning plus high-dose IL-2, and the modality which has been really led to a renaissance in cell therapy was developed by Carl June, Michelle Sandlin, and others to redirect T cells. In this particular case, for example, by directing cells to recognize a CD19 marker on B cell malignancies or BCMA on myeloma. This also requires lymphodepletion and some amount of genetic engineering. The form of cell therapy I'll discuss is endogenous T cell therapy, in which these cells are derived, these antigen specific T cells are sourced from the peripheral blood and then used enabling technologies. Enrich for a population of memory cells and expand them to large numbers for adoptive transfer. And I think sort of going back to first principles, why did we choose to embark on a 20-year, I guess, journey to generate these T cells for clinical use? And I think by starting with a broad T cell receptor population that may be naive or contain precursor cells, we have the opportunity to target multiple antigens and also provide sort of an unbiased starting T cell repertoire. Also, this has become a source of memory cells, potential multifunctional capacity. Enriching these antigen-specific T cells in vitro required some technologies being pioneered and developed the last decade or two. The cyclical antigen stimulation sort of preserves the physiology of these T cells, so they respond to low dose of physiologic levels of cytokines after adoptive transfer, but also we can epigenetically modulate these cells to program them for essential memory phenotype, both at the genetic and epigenetic level. Because they are highly persistent after adoptive transfer, and we've shown this in several first-in-human studies, conditioning is not required, and therefore the associated gene-related toxicities are not observed. Also allows us to apply combination-based strategies early on without having to wait for the toxicity associated with conditioning or high-dose IL-2 to resolve. The third question then, this seems relatively straightforward and simplistic, and why has it not been done before? And I think part of that really lies in the biology and the frequency of these relatively rare tumor antigen-specific T cells, which we show in the Science Immunology paper not too long ago was present at a frequency of less than 1 in 1 million. To get these to a uniform T cell product of more than 80% uniformity for defined specificity and phenotype required the development of enabling technologies, one of which was IL-21 priming, in vitro stimulation, followed by MEMS-based, attachment-based cell sorting, and expansion to numbers sufficient for adoptive transfer. And then just real quickly, you know, what we've done over this time was first demonstrate that these T cells do exist, that they can be isolated by attachment-based or other marker-based cell sorting, and that it was safe to generate these first by brute force cloning a uniform population of antigen-specific T cells that showed modest responses, but also evidence of antigen spreading, in this case, to use antigen-specific CD4 T cells, but that central memory phenotype and
deriving these cells from a centromeric pool was important, and then prospectively developing a method using IL-21 priming to generate these antigen-specific T cells, which led to enhanced persistence and the ability to target antigens that were represented by several solid tumor malignancies. This led to combination-based therapy, the first prospective antigen-specific T cell therapy trial with ipilimumab or checkpoint inhibitor, and then an understanding based upon these studies of what was required for at least effective PTC-based therapy. Certainly persistence of one of these cells persist long-term at relatively high frequency for months, if not years after adoptive transfer without high-dose lymphodepletion or high-dose IL-2 at frequencies 0.5 to 8% in the peripheral blood. And demonstrating antigen spreading was seen in all the responders in a recent study who received targeted single epitope therapy, but then saw responses to other non-targeted antigens developed in these patients. The absence of lymphodepletion also allowed for this extant tumor reactive population to develop. These responses were not small peripheral responses, but sometimes very large, bulky disease. That although took a long time to completely resolve, received no other therapy except for the T cells, single dose, and a course of CTLA-4 in those who have failed checkpoint therapy. This has led to actually a number of studies. Probably if you accumulate all the patients that we've done in several small scale studies, about 66 patients, of about half have had evidence of immune-related response, fulfilled that criteria, but we also have clear evidence of partial and durable complete responses in several of these patients in which checkpoint therapy or other chemo-based therapies was not a factor, and only the infusion of T cells appeared to mediate a long-term response. I'll point out one of these cases here for the reason that this patient was actually an American Airlines pilot who had both visceral and CNS tumor and did fairly well. So it is obviously a personal case in which we felt attached to sort of seeing that this individual would have the benefit of receiving this type of therapy for which he had no TIL source or any other options at the time. You can see here after adoptive transfer, sorry, it's a little bit small here to see, but his visceral disease had resolved completely and the CNS tumor, this one of several tumors in his brain had resolved, demonstrating a systemic administration can also lead to durable responses in the CNS. This was accompanied by an increase in the central memory type T cell that was observed. Now, this is tetramer-based gated cells in the peripheral blood after adoptive transfer. These cells reacquired a central memory phenotype characterized by high CD28 and a high IL-7 receptor CD127 expression on the surface that was commensurate with long-term persistence and also antigen spreading. The sort of math or formula, I guess, in a way to sort of describe what we're trying to do here is that by starting with a broad T cell receptor repertoire together with IL-21 exposure during priming of these cells in vitro, we can generate these memory T cells. And we'll show you a little bit later actually what the epigenetic consequences of that are. These memory T cells lead to long-term persistence without high-dose lymphodepletion or high-dose IL-2, and this persistence means that no conditioning IL-2 is required. Because no conditioning IL-2 is required, you have the opportunity for antigen spreading. Not saying you couldn't go ahead with this multivalent therapy, but we believe that antigen spreading is important. What these actual antigen-specific T cells are, this may be a surrogate, what we've shown here, maybe neoantigen-specific cells or T cells that can other tumor-associated antigens, which we haven't defined, but it appears antigen spreading does limit the outgrowth of antigen loss variants, at least in the patients who experience a durable response. And without conditioning IL-2, you can then implement combination therapy early, and so persistence antigen spreading combination therapy can lead to durable complete responses. Sorry for the bad animation here, but this is an example of another patient who had a durable complete response. And what this is meant to illustrate is that patients with complete response, they may receive cells that appear similar on the surface. They look like effective memory cells, but the persistent T cells acquire central memory phenotype characterized, as I mentioned before, by high CD28 and IL-7 receptor levels. So all T cells are equal, but some are more equal than others. And so we decided we would try and understand this in a prospective fashion using a naive CD8 positive population of T cells from the PBMC of healthy donors and also patients, stimulate them in vitro with peptide pulse autologous dendritic cells and expose them to various gamma chain receptor cytokines, 2, 7, 15, or IL-21,
and then simply assay a day 14 for phenotype and function. It turns out phenotypically, in the absence of IL-21, you have a relatively low CD127 population that with IL-21 leaves that regulation of CD62L and CD27 shown here. You can see in several samples of both patient and healthy donors, there's increase in these central memory type markers. But not only that, the CD28 regulation is stable when these cells occur in the radiated feeders. Oops, sorry about that. And they also make IL-2. As you can see here, adding CTLA-4-Ig blocks the CD28 immune production of IL-2 in these IL-21 prime T cells, as you can see here. Also, these cells with retrieval IL-21 are much more sensitive to proliferation when exposed subsequently to gamma chain receptor cytokines. So basically, this puts us in a sort of differentiation pathway with high prolific capacity and inducible cytolytic capacity. These cells exposed to IL-21 during priming give a multi-cytokine function, but more importantly, an autocrine antigen-driven source of IL-2, making these fairly unique helper-independent T cells, at least for human antigen-specific T cell. We asked ourselves, what is the signaling mechanism that's involved and distinguishes IL-21 from other gamma chain receptor cytokines? And you can see here, STAT3 or phospho-STAT3 is important and dominant signal for IL-21 engagement. And then over the next 8 years, when we made this discovery and finally published this past month, it turns out that this happens at a transcriptional level. So a regulation of CD28 expression when exposed to IL-21 occurs at the transcript level when exposure to shRNA to STAT3 suppresses this, suggesting that it is phospho-STAT3 mediated. And then since we didn't really have any knockout humans, we took advantage of the fact that patients with Jobe syndrome actually have been a little dominant negative, functionally, I guess, STAT3 negative phenotype in treatment of these patients. PBMC with IL-21 does not upregulate CD28 as seen here. And that when we did ChIP-seq analysis, phospho-STAT3 binds to a proximal distal region of the CD28 gene. And therefore is responsible for driving that expression in these cells, also energetically more fit than cells that are not exposed to IL-21. What does that translate to in vivo for adoptive transfer? In one of the first studies where IL-21 prime T cells were given to patients, in this case targeting WT1, an AML specific target, well, I guess it's not specific, but an AML target in patients who previously received a transplant and now were then given either IL-21 prime WT1 specific T cells or unprimed but WT1 specific cells. And in those patients, for example, this particular patient whose T cell product was generated without IL-21, you see relatively low levels of the central memory markers in the T cell product. As you track these T cells after adoptive transfer, they do not upregulate these central memory markers. In these two patients, for example, here we see that the T cell product has relatively moderate to nominal levels of these central memory markers. And then at day 280, where these cells still persist at relatively high levels, and you gate on the tetramer-based WT1 specific population, you see that IL-21 did induce a phenotype that could be reconstituted in vivo to express high levels of CD27, CD28, and CD127 seen in both these patients here at day plus 250 and day plus 280. Functionally, what does that mean? These are three patients that received T cells targeting WT1 without IL-21 priming. And here, what you see is the frequency of cells in the black bar, and in the red bar is the leukemic clone. And you can see here the blast cells nearing 100% relapse rate in all these patients who then failed. And then in the patients who had IL-21 WT1 specific T cells persisted long term, and none of these patients relapsed. This wasn't a randomized trial, but in almost all patients with high risk AML, they will relapse eventually, and this offered protection against that. This is another example of why persistence is important in adoptive cell therapy. And we think we demonstrate relatively unequivocally in this case, for example, in these 10 patients, we're able to track individual clonal types for the angiospecific T cell population, in this case, T cells in patients with metastatic melanoma targeting MART1 or GP100. There was little or no conditioning. Patients received IL-21 prime T cells, followed by a single course of CTLA-4 therapy. Several of these patients who responded had failed a prior ipilimumab therapy, but they received that in combination with the IL-21 prime T cells. As you can see here, patients who had a complete response We could track their half-life. The clonal type half-life of these two patients was relatively long compared to those who had only experienced a partial response compared to those who had stable disease. And certainly for those with progressive disease, the average clonal type half-life of the T-cell product was significantly lower than those patients who had a durable complete or partial response, now, suggesting almost equivocally that the half-life of the T-cells correlates with the clinical response. Question arises then, where exactly did these T cells come from? So because we could track the clonal type of these cells and we could look at each individual T cell product, for example, in patient one here, we find that 10 T cell receptor clone types make up about 98% of the T cell product, which is uniformly targeted to a single antigen. This relatively low clonal type diversity represents majority of product and seen most of these patient T cell products. The blue section of the pie represents those T-cell receptor sequences that are detected in the T-cell product but could not be found in the peripheral blood of these patients prior to adoptive transfer. So they must have come from a very low frequency pool, possibly a naive or precursor T-cell pool, because the sensitivity of PCR is at least 1 in 100,000 or 1 in a million. On the other hand, this orange slice of the pie represents those T-cell clone types that can be detected in the peripheral blood of patients even before adoptive transfer and represent perhaps an angio-experienced population due to in situ vaccination by the tumor. And perhaps not surprisingly, it's these T cell clones which derive from relatively low frequency or naive T cell pool which persist after adoptive transfer is here completely overlapping the tetramer-based frequency analyzed in these patients, the angio-experienced pool actually making only a relatively small component of the entire persistent T cell population after adoptive transfer. Remember, this is a log scale. Suggesting, in fact, two things. One is that it is possible to generate these T cells from a naive T cell pool, and it makes sense in a way because IL-21 priming and central memory phenotype is more likely derived from a pool that is less, undergone fewer cycles of division, but also that the ability to generate T cells, at least in this approach, is relatively robust. So even though the frequency is relatively low, one can imagine generating T cells from almost any immunogenic epitope. So if we look at the sort of landscape of what sort of cells are in the T cell product of cells in ETC, we have a largely central memory or early central memory phenotype in FLT3 because they're exposed constantly to antigen and because CAR T cells undergo in vitro stimulation prior to adoptive transfer. They sort of sit somewhere in this scale of the differentiation pathway. And although we can generate central memory type T cells, it seems that giving IL-21 to TIL cells or CAR T cells as a means to reprogram cells is not possible. When we did the study a little more rigorously and looked at effector T cells compared to naive T cells, we see that phospho-STAT3 is upregulated in both populations, but you do not see a regulation of CD20 in effector T cells. And no increase in CD28 by MFI or by RNA transcript levels. So what we imagine happening is that, phospho-STAT3 can bind to the promoter region of CD28 in the naive T cell population, but chromatin inaccessibility rejects phospho-STAT3 in the more differentiated cell, perhaps not surprising. And so we took the logical step of pre-exposing these effector T cells, in this case TIL or TCRT, to an HDAC inhibitor, to acetylate the histone and allow IL-21 mediated phospho-STAT3 to bind to the promoter region of CD28. And it turns out that's exactly what happens. These effector CD8 T cells, when engaged through the T cell receptor and pre-exposed to HDAC inhibitor, you can see here they do inhibit pre-exposure to SAHA. These cells do permit engagement of the phospho-STAT3 to the promoter region. Providing some additional histone accessibility and the ability really to reprogram these cells both by phenotype, as you can see here, a regulation of CD28 only in those effector cells that were previously exposed to an HDAC inhibitor, CD28, CD62 ligand. It also enhances effector function, enzyme B and perforin. You can see here quite clearly that prior exposure to an HDAC inhibitor leads to a regulation of this CD62L, CD28 positive phenotype in cells with IL-21 exposure compared to those who receive IL-21 alone. Functionally, HDAC inhibitors can inhibit growth in the viability of T cells, but the manner and the dose in which they're given allowed us to preserve function, both in terms of the ability to expand in vivo and also to kill the targets, maybe related to the class of histone deacetylase inhibitor, which you're using. And furthermore, you see that they continue to have increased sensitivity to gamma chain receptor kinds after exposure to IL-21 with pentobinostat pretreatment here. This is published, so you can read about all this. But I think really what that allows us to do is sort of, reprogram may be too strong a word, but does allow us to generate a more uniform population of central memory T cells for both TL and CAR T and TCR-T T cell products as well. So moving on to a second aspect of this, which I think some of you might find interesting, in that moving to identify new targets is certainly one of the ways of, democratizing, certainly democratize is a word we all use these days for other reasons, but I think bringing this to a larger population. And the CAR T cell targets, as I mentioned before, are relatively limited. And for solid tumors, certainly there are many contenders, although they have yet to be proven to be safe and effective. TCR targets are limited, at least commercially, to melanoma-associated antigens and certain CT antigens, which have been described as relatively immunogenic, like MAGE-A4 and NY-ESO-1. However, these are relatively low intensity of expression, less than 2 transcripts per megabase, at least by the TCGA and other RNA-seq databases, and overall very low prevalence among all the different tumor types. And if you put this in some context, you here see these melanoma-associated antigens restricted by HLA-A2, seen in skin cancer, melanoma, and uveal melanoma, MAGE-A4 and NY-ESO-1 largely restricted to lung cancer, and actually primarily squamous cell cancer, and obviously certain types of sarcoma. We took a slightly different approach, Lane or others are familiar with, which is using an antigen discovery pipeline by tandem aspect elution of peptides from the MHC of the actual tumor site. Just eluding these and applying certain in silico algorithms, but to demonstrate this empirically, in this case, using our ETC workflow. It's a relatively robust workflow. It is relatively tedious, though, but it will allow us to elicit a population of peptide-specific T cells, that we can now use to validate in terms of their ability to truly be tumor-reactive. So immunogenicity, we define as basically a peptide epitope that can be eluted from the MHC of tumor cells that elicits a T cell response with sufficient affinity that it recognizes a tumor endogenously expressing the antigen of interest that presents the peptide MHC on the surface with sufficient density to initiate TCR antigen-specific killing. Really workflow allows us to empirically validate these peptide epitopes of defined by tandem mass spec. But furthermore, we'll take this further by cloning out the alpha and beta chain of the T cell receptor, transferring specificity to a polyclonal population, and demonstrating, in fact, that these two, in fact, recognize endogenous expressing antigen on tumor targets. This is where we are, really. We've taken about 40 tumors, 428,000 spectra, reduced these to about 200 high-value targets with a median transcription per transcript per megabase intensity of 18. As you can see, it is sort of a heat map. Anywhere from anything above 4 really is considered immunogenic, but we have values here as high as 30, 40, 50, over 100 across several tumor types for a given epitope, for example. And we see them across several HLA class alleles, 5 different HLA class 1 alleles that represent over 3/4 of the Caucasian and Asian patients. You can see across here a broad swath of solid tumor types. And we selected on basis of their even though these are normal tumor-associated antigens, and of course they're shared, we select on the basis of tumor selectivity, so that most of them are cancer testis or cancer testis-like antigens. In a few cases, like the prostate cancer targets here, which express very high levels in prostate cancer, they're also expressed in, I guess you'd call it a dispensable tissue of the prostate, for example.
Dr. Yi, I'm sorry to interrupt, but I did want to leave time for questions at the end.
Okay. I'm going to just mention real quickly here that this is one of the targets we use, CT46, which allows us to target various different solid tumors. I'm going to skip through the process here, which we described already, but also another target which is publishing, read about Nature Communications,
is this VGOL vestigial antigen, which is found originally in pancreatic cancer but expressed in a whole bunch of other tumor malignancies. And finally, the last thing I'm going to mention here is that you can take this database and you can cross it against different rare tumor RNA-seq proteomics IHC and come up with several tumor-associated antigen targets for these rare tumors, for which normally very difficult to identify tumor targets. So let me get right to the most important slide here, which is the credits. And so we have time for questions. I think that basically this is the group and the funding received from the Parker Institute, the NIH Cancer Research Institute's longtime supporter. And I thank you for your time.
Thank you very much. That was an absolutely fascinating talk. So I'll start with the first couple seem to be centered around the IL-21. So the first one that we got was, what does IL-21 do to checkpoint molecules or inhibitory receptors?
We don't know directly, obviously. It turns out the IL-21 cells have low levels of TIM-3. I guess you can consider that checkpoint a molecule. And seem to be resistant to hypoxia. I know that's not a checkpoint, but something to consider in terms of cells as they move towards exhaustion. So in this case, what we do have is upregulation of CD28, obviously, which binds to B7. So it's not exactly an answer to your question, but the rationale for adding CTLA-4 in that case was to provide unfettered B7-CD20 interaction by distracting CTLA-4. But I think what we do know is these cells are energetically more fit. They're less likely to be exhausted, and we're trying to study the mechanisms of that. Kunal Rai here is helping us study that in an epigenetic, drilling down in deeper fashion. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So I know you showed STAT3 in the presentation, but Dr. Lee asked, is there any role for STAT5 in mediating CD28 expression?
Yeah, so we didn't see that exactly. So it's interesting. I mean, obviously IL-21 drives both phospho-STAT3 and phospho-STAT5. As it turns out, phospho-STAT5, you know, through the other cytokines may actually be, they actually compete for the same region of the CD20 promoter, at least on gross analysis. And we're gonna break that down a little more closely, but it's a good question. And I think we haven't fully understand because it's really contextual. I mean, other things upregulate phospho-STAT3 like oncostatin M and IL-6, but they don't give us the same effect. And so there may be other cofactors involved. What phospho-STAT5 role is, that is not clear, although I do agree. I mean, we do need a strong effector component in whatever it is that we do.
Mm-hmm. Now, specifically with the IL-21, do you think, and this is a question by Dr. Jin, do you think it would be more beneficial to treat patients with IL-21 after transfer, or equip the T cells that you transfer with the ability to produce IL-21?
Yeah, make sure I understand this, but I do want to raise the point that the context is very important. You know, giving IL-21 during priming will give you the essential memory. Giving IL-21 later on actually increases IL-10 production, but also increases granzyme and perfin. So obviously, you know, it'll regulate different genes in different fashion. We've never given IL-21 in vivo to these patients. There's reason to believe actually that might be helpful in many of those respects as well. I'm happy to discuss that in more detail later.
Mm-hmm. And then just quickly, the last one that we have, what do you think of using radiation therapy or chemotherapy as a strategy for ETC?
Yeah, it's great. I mean, we actually do have a collaboration with somebody who's doing some stereotactic radiation therapy for whatever magic that radiation does. And I'm sure Sanjay Damare and many other people have described how that might have a class one or increased filtration. Actually, I don't know the exact mechanism, but I absolutely agree. The chemotherapy you have to be very careful with, obviously. I'm not sure this distinguishes between immunogenic and non-immunogenic chemotherapy, but there are chemotherapy, for example, that might, you know, decrease MDSCs, for example, some of the drugs are already in use for sarcoma. So there may be a synergistic additive effect.
Mm-hmm. All right, I think that is it for our time. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Well, that was truly amazing. I think at one point we had about 180 participants in our symposium. Let's see, we lose a few, but most of you stayed. That shows the quality of the program. I'm Dr. Zihai Li, again, the director of the PIO. I want to thank all of you, whether you are from Columbus or somewhere else, for your support to the mission of the broader, I guess, the entire immuno-oncology community. And of course, specifically for your support to PIO. I want to thank also the PIO staff and the entire team for that matter for putting this event together. I certainly couldn't do anything here without them. And last, but certainly not least, I want to thank all the amazing speakers, seven speakers, visionary leaders in the field, and also the seven moderators, as well as the poster presenter for really enriching this quite amazing program. I think this will do it. I think this will conclude our second PIO annual symposium. I hope to really see you guys in person in not too distant future. So at this point, so long from Columbus, Ohio. Thank you.